All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to SPBC TV again. We're here live streaming the Div 1 Game 2 Grand Final game between the Surfers Bluewave and the Redlands Rays. I'm your host for the game, John Reimers, and with me again on the mic, my co-commentator, Owen Drinkwater. How are you going, Owen?
Doing well, John. Looking forward to this one. After an exciting, maybe not exciting, but a good win for the Bluewave Division 2 Championship. And rain is falling here at Windsor, but hopefully if it stays at this sort of steady level, we'll be able to get this one in. This one's do or die for the Bluewave as they lost on Friday night. And so this series is best of three. If they can't get it to one apiece, that'll be a championship for Redlands. So the boys will be ready to go tonight, I'm sure.
Yes, it's we're amped up after that Bluewave win. Going a shutout with Fitzy on the mound. 10-0.
So for the Bluewave today, as the home team in this one, it'll be Steve Chambers on the mound. Steve, a longtime veteran of the ABL, has played professionally over in various places in Asia as well, and I'm sure some other places that I either have forgotten or I'm not aware of. Great leadership presence at the club, always stays calm and within himself, and has been a workhorse for this Blue Waves team through the regular season and into the postseason. Reminder, we'll just review, just like we did the last time these guys met Friday night. So Redlands Rays were the number one team in the regular season, taking the minor premiership at 27-9. Surfers was tied for third at 25-11. Redlands won their series against Rapids to move on to the grand final directly, while Surfers dispatched of Pine Hills and then subsequently beat Pine Rivers Rapids in a best of three series to earn their spot in this grand final. These teams met in the regular season four times and split the series 2-2, and their first game on Friday night was won in walk-off fashion by Redlands on a single up the middle by Kai Ashby. So they took that one 2-1, and we'll see Ryan Duncan stepping in against Steve Chambers to start this game two of the grand final series, as Chambers misses with the first one for ball one. Next pitch is just inside for ball two. Chambers quickly behind 2-0. We'll go through the lineups here again. It's a similar lineup to Friday for Redlands as Chambers delivers a 2-0. And fastball upstairs. It's Ryan Duncan in left field leading off. Anthony Gomez, the shortstop, hitting second. Tyson Zamora, the center fielder, hitting third. Kyle Ashby, the catcher, in the cleanup hole. And Kyle Pike, DHing, hitting fifth. As Chambers delivers a 3-0 downstairs, so Duncan works a four-pitch walk. Dan Turner at third base hitting sixth. Reese Knitt, Friday night's starting pitcher, playing first and hitting seventh. Kynan Melander hitting eighth and playing second base. And in the nine hole, it's Beckham Crooks, the right fielder, to round it out for the Rays, as Anthony Gomez will step to the plate. Duncan a four-pitch walk and Gomez to the plate. Gomez had a good game on Friday night. 2-for-4 in that one. As Chambers delivers a pitch just off the corner, and so Chambers five straight balls to start this one. Ryan Duncan, not really a threat to steal, you wouldn't think. As the pitch is grounded, and a shattered bat for Gomez, pitch grounded foul down the third baseline, so Gomez will look for some new lumber. And we'll go around the field for Surfers. You got Steve Chambers on the mound. You've got Jerry Lakeo, the stalwart behind the plate. Andy Cosgrove, Atsuki Takahashi, Matt Hughes getting the start in this one at second, and then Jai Diebel over at first base. That's third to first on the infield. And then you've got Ricky Diebel in left, Max Durrington in center, and the Surfers slugger Harry White out in right field to round it out. So a couple of small changes from Friday night, mostly based on the pitchers moving around and playing. That goes for Redlands as well. Hey. And Gomez has found himself some new wood. And he'll step back in and look at a 1-1 from Chambers. Cosgrove back on the grass, not expecting the bunt. Back off the grass, rather. And Gomez drives one hard into right center field. It looks like that's going to split the outfielders, and it's going to go to the wall. Darrington picks it up and throws it in from center. But not before Gomez finds himself on second base with a stand-up double, and the Redland Rays are in business here in the top of the first. Duncan around to third on that play. So Gomez christens his new bat with a double, and that brings up the speedy Tyson Zamora. Zamora 1-for-4 on Friday night as he takes ball one upstairs. And Zamora this postseason struggling a little bit, just 3-for-15 so far. And he grounds one towards first. Tough pick. Diebel making the play to home. Throw to Lakeo is going to be in time to get Duncan. So a nice pick by Jai Diebel and making a good decision to go after Duncan at home plate. Duncan thrown out by a couple of steps there, no slide. And so Chambers remains with a clean bill thus far. Zamora reaches on the fielder's choice, and it's first and third, one out for the cleanup hitter, Ashby. Ashby, the hero of Friday night. I apologize, it was not Ashby, it was Pike who walked off the Friday night game. Ashby had walked in front of Pike. Surfer's looking for a ball on the ground here to get him out of the inning. And pitch is swung on and missed by Ashby for strike one. Speedy Zamora over at first and Gomez at third. Some good speed on both sides for Redlands. And breaking pitch is in the dirt. Lakeo keeps it in front of him. And no throw down as Zamora is able to move up to second base on what will likely be a wild pitch. So that takes away the double play. Now you're looking at second and third for Ashby. As the rain continues to fall here at Windsor. Ashby having a good postseason so far, 4-for-11, 4 walks. It's good for a 1.045 OPS. And he flares one into shallow center. Darrington coming in. Gomez tagging. Play is made. Gomez draws the throw, and Diebel cuts it off. So a nice job by Darrington to put a good throw on the money there. And that ball shallow enough that Gomez is unable to score. And all of a sudden, Chambers one out away from yet again dancing out of trouble. Something Surfers has done all weekend long. And it'll be last night's hero, Kyle Pike. Kyle Pike singled up the middle to walk off the game Friday night. Not last night, rather. Friday night. He was 1-for-4 in that game. And wouldn't have played in the prior series as he's listed as just 1-for-4 for the postseason. Chambers comes set now. And first pitch to Pike is a big breaking ball that misses just above the zone. And fastball upstairs for ball two. So Chambers, a little bit of trouble with control early in this game. You have to wonder if the weather has something to do with that. See what we see from the Redlands starter, Griffin Baker, when it's his turn to come out. And pitches skied out of play. Chambers now 15 pitches, only 6 strikes to this point. Defense basically straight up for Pike here. As that pitch is going to hit him in the shoulder, and Pike will take first base. So base is now loaded for Dan Turner. Turner 2-for-4 on Friday night. Just 3-for-15 in this postseason after a good regular season. 3.41 average in the regular season in 35 games. And a little bit of deja vu from Friday night's first inning, where Dan Turner ended it by grounding to short with the bases loaded and 2 outs. Chambers ready and deals. Breaking ball downstairs for ball 1. Nowhere to put Turner with Reese Knitt on deck. And you would be forgiven for thinking that Knitt isn't much of a hitter after seeing how good his pitching performance was on Friday night, but that is not the case. He can also swing the bat. And Turner will get hit. And with the bases loaded, that will force Gomez across for the first run for Redlands. And the Rays will take a 1-0 lead. Chambers a little bit frustrated with himself back-to-back hit by pitches here. And again, uncharacteristic of Steve Chambers, who is generally quite economical, precise control. So you wonder if the weather plays a factor here as Reese Knitt strides to the plate. And first pitch is a breaking ball in for a strike. We'll have a look at Knitt's numbers with the bat this year. So Knitt, who was the best pitcher on the Redlands team this year, also swung the bat to a tune of .365 batting average and a .929 OPS in 23 games as he swings through a big breaking ball for strike 2 and finds himself quickly in an 0-2 hole. So we'll see if Chambers can limit the damage here. Zamora's away from third, Pike away from second, and Turner away from first. Bases loaded, 2 outs here in the top of the first. 1-0 Rays here in game 2 of this GBL Division 1 Grand Final Series. And pitches very high. Jerry Lacayo makes an acrobatic leaping catch to prevent the ball to the backstop and keeps Zamora at third. A great play by the Surfers catcher. And took every inch of Jerry Lacayo there to keep that one from going to the backstop. Chambers will reset, and it'll be a 1-2 to Knitt. And time is called. So a 1-2 from Chambers coming, and did he go? No, he did not. So the appeal down to first, Reese Knitt did not swing. And so the count now goes to 2-2 with 2 outs here in the top of the first. Nice job by Knitt to hold up on what was a good breaking pitch from Chambers. And the 2-2 is swung on and hit hard to third. Cosgrove stays down on it. And he'll beat Pike to the bag to limit the damage. So at the end of a half inning, the Rays push 1 across, but Chambers strands 3, and it'll be Surfers coming to bat in the bottom of the first. All right, back here, bottom of the first, as the Rays starter, Griffin Baker, finishes his warm-up pitches. It'll be Andy Cosgrove to lead off. We'll go through the Surfers lineup quickly here. So, Andy Cosgrove playing third and leading off. You got Max Darrington in center hitting second. Jai Diebel, the first baseman, hitting third. Harrison White, cleanup hitter for Surfers in right field tonight. Jerry Lacayo hitting in the five hole and catching. You got Ricky Diebel playing left tonight. He was Friday night starter. He'll be in the sixth slot. And then Scott Cronin has DH duties in the seven. Matt Hughes getting his first start of the grand final, playing second base and hitting eighth. And Atsuki Takahashi, the shortstop, to round it out as Baker delivers the first pitch to Cosgrove. And he sees one just down for ball one. And upstairs for ball two. So quickly 2-0 on Cosgrove. We talked a little bit about Andy Cosgrove Friday night. We'll just go through some of the categories that he is amongst the top 10 from the regular season as he swings hard at a 2-0 and fouls it away. So Cosgrove led the league in batting this year at 444. He also led the league in on base at 556. His OPS also led the league at 1.341. He tied for the league in hits with 56 hits this season. Second in the league in doubles with 16. That was behind Wade Dutton's 22. Led the league in triples with 6. He was on the home run leaderboard, tied for 4th with 5 home runs this year. RBIs, he was 5th with 31 and a tie for 5th as he takes ball 3. Third in the league in walks with 30. Plate appearances, he was 4th in the league at 162. And 3-1 hard swing and a foul. Full count on Cosgrove now. He was amongst the top 10 in at-bats at 126. Cosgrove stole 19 bags. That was good for 6th in the league. So every single positive offensive category that the GBL keeps track of, you're going to see Andy Cosgrove's name in the top 10 this year. Sparkling season for Cosgrove, and he has continued it in the playoffs. And the full count pitches downstairs, so Cosgrove will take a leadoff walk, and that'll bring up the young center fielder, Max Darrington. And speaking of league leaders, right behind Andy Cosgrove's 444 average was the only other player to hit 400, and that was the young Max Darrington, who hit 400 on the nose this year. Again, this is amongst qualified hitters. Requirement was at least 95 plate appearances. Darrington, a tough night on Friday, 0 for 4. And Baker left-handed, so we'll see if he's got a tricky move to get Cosgrove as Darrington takes strike one over the inside corner. Both starters not quite showing their maximum level at this stage. Baker rolling over the fastball about 76 to 78, and Chambers right around the same ballpark there. As the 0-1 to Darrington is a breaking ball over his head, and the count runs even. Cosgrove, 19 stolen bases this year, only caught 3 times. And 1-1 to Darrington is in the dirt for ball 2. Bluewave is a team that runs and was a team that tested Ashby to the tune of 3 stolen bases on Friday night, though Jai Diebel was thrown out attempting to steal as well. It'll be a 2-1 now from Baker. And Darrington hits it hard into right field, and it's going back towards the wall. Crooks tracking, and it's going to one-hop the wall in right center field. Darrington rounding second. Cosgrove rounding third, and he's held up. And now going for home as the throw is bobbled. The play at the plate. Cosgrove safe at home. So a bobble out there by Redlands second baseman Kynan Melander on the short hop from either Crooks or Zamora allowed Cosgrove, who had hesitated around third, to take off for home, and he beat the throw into the plate, which was just up the line. And so Darrington's aboard with an RBI double, and just like that, Surfers has evened the game at 1 apiece. And that'll be a weight off Max Darrington's shoulders after a tough Friday night to get the game started with a booming double here, which on a warmer night, you have to wonder if it would have traveled just that little bit more. But with the rain falling and the field a little bit soggy, you don't expect as much of that tonight. And so it'll be Jai Deeble with Durrington away from second and nobody out. And Deeble shows bunt, lays it down. It's in fair territory. Throw to third. And not a great decision by Ashby there, who hesitated, looked to third, and Durrington just beat it out under the throw. So we'll see how they score it for Deeble. It could be scored a fielder's choice, even though Durrington was safe. The bunt Deeble put down just a couple of feet away from the catcher, Ashby, who because of that thought he might have had a play at third, but Durrington just too fast. And now a lot of speed on the bases for Surfers and still nobody out as the dangerous Harry White steps in. First pitch is grounded towards first. Nip knocks it down, steps on the bag, throw home, and Durrington under the tag. So a nice job by Max Durrington to beat the throw from Reese Nitt at first. That ball two-hop Nitt right near the bag, so immediately eliminated Harry White. But Durrington again, just too fast. And maybe a perfect throw gets him, but Nitt's throw a little high, and Durrington gets underneath it. Surfers leads 2-1. Deeble advances to second on the throw. And so the Blue Wave take their first lead of this Grand Final series as Jerry Lacayo takes a ball outside. And we don't have an official score on Deeble's ball at the moment. Looks like they're still deliberating. Baker set and the 1-0. Is outside 2-0. Lacayo 250 this postseason, 360 on base. So it'll be a 2-0 here from Baker as the Blue Wave are making him work a little bit, and pitches upstairs 3-0. If Lacayo were to reach, it'd be Ricky Deeble, the left fielder coming to the plate next. And Deeble's ball, yes, scored a fielder's choice as Max Durrington advances to third on that one. And then Harrison White with the ground out. And Lacayo takes ball four above the zone, so a four-pitch walk for him. And that'll bring Ricky Deeble to the plate. Ricky Deeble this year, a 306 average with a home run, 417 on base. This postseason, 267 average, but a 458 on base, helped by 7 walks for the Surfers lefty. And he shows bunt. Ball goes to the backstop there. Quick bounce off the bricks, but no play for Ashby as Deeble moves to third and Lacayo to second. So now two ducks on the pond for Ricky Deeble with a chance to open up a bit of a lead for the Blue Wave here. They already lead 2-1, and only one away. So Redlands infield going to about halfway, a hard hit ground ball, you figure any of the infielders might have a play at home, but with Jai Deeble's speed and base running instincts, you'd think it would be a tough play. And Deeble takes above the zone, that's ball two. We'll give you a bit of Griffin's numbers, Griffin Baker's numbers, if we have a chance here from the regular season. And then we'll go to Steve Chambers as well in the second inning as Ricky Deeble takes strike one. So So Griffin Baker shouldered most of the load that behind Reese Knitt for this team. 72 innings pitched to the tune of a 5-2 record, scattered 57 hits, 25 earned runs, and 80 strikeouts in those 72 innings. And an ERA of 3.13 as Stiebel takes downstairs for another ball. So it'll be a 3-0 pitch to Diebel. And he takes strike one. If Diebel were to reach, it'd be the bases loaded for Cronin with Matt Hughes to follow him. Baker comes set and it'll be a 3-1 to Ricky Diebel. And pitches in the dirt. Nice block by Ashby to keep the runners where they are, but it's another walk for Ricky Diebel, and that'll bring Scott Cronin to the plate. And Knitt and Ashby both out to the mound to chat to Baker. And having watched the top of the first and now this bottom of the first, you have to think that this weather is playing a role for these pitchers. What do you reckon, John?
Yes, the pitch is definitely getting a little bit loose, especially a couple of wild pitches way over the catcher's heads. Ball just slipping out of the grip just a little early in the pitch. Not able to really grip and pull down on the ball.
Both teams doing their best. Looks like they're trying to dry the balls as much as they can, but this field's been wet all day. And again, credit to the Windsor grounds crew here for keeping the field ready and helping us getting these games in. But you certainly imagine it's playing a role for these guys, and we'll see if Cronin is aggressive or looking to take a strike after those. And he is aggressive. And has a rip and a miss for strike one. That was a swing that looked like he wanted to make it 6-1. So let's take a breath, settles himself, and he'll see an 0-1 from Baker. And another swing and a miss. So we've been a little ahead of both pitches from Baker. We'll see if Baker tries to pull the string again or tries to dial it up. And that is a fastball upstairs. That one up to 79 from Baker. Neither pitcher has touched 80 miles an hour yet at this point, though both are capable. One, two from Baker is a slow curveball that Cronin swings through. So after setting him up with 79 upstairs, he pulls the string at 67, and Cronin will sit down. And so it'll be Matt Hughes, our first time seeing Matt Hughes in the batter's box this Grand Final series. Hughes, a bit of a difficult season with the bat this year, and limited appearances in the postseason to this point as he takes strike one. Some history against Redlands in the postseason, though, for Matt Hughes, as he did homer off of Redlands last year in the initial semifinal, which Surfers won. And we'll see what Hughes can do with bases full of Blue Wave. And pitches chopped foul. As the meeting with Baker seems to have been effective, as he's now found the zone 5 of his last 6, and maybe able to get out of this, again, like Chambers, limiting the damage and leaving 3 base runners. .28 pitches now for Baker. This will be number 29. And fastball up and away for ball one. So it'll be at least a 30-pitch inning for Baker. Chambers had thrown 23 pitches. in the first. So we'll see how long these starters go. It sounds like the bullpen may be a story. Looks like it might be Oscar Hyde out there getting loose for the Rays as early as the first here. And Hughes takes up and away for ball two. So it'll be Diebel away from third. The courtesy runner for Lacayo away from second, and the other Diebel away from first as Hughes takes up and away again for ball three. Looks like Jake Scott out there at second. Courtesy runner for Lacayo. So full count, two outs here in the bottom of the first. 2-1 Surfers leads already and looking to add. The runners will be released. And so you figure a single scores two and a double might score three. We'll see what Hughes can do here with a 3-2 coming from Baker. And foul back, and we'll do it again. So a good at bat from Hughes. This is something we were hoping to see from the Blue Wave and didn't see as much of on Friday, as working the count of the starter. Now Nitt does make that difficult because he's all around the zone, but with Baker missing here in this rainy day on Sunday, the boys are working the count and working the pitch count. So Hughes has done his job in terms of having a good at-bat. We'll see if he can finish it with a hit. And he lines one foul just down the third baseline, and we'll do it again. So it'll be the eighth pitch of the at-bat coming to Hughes. Diebel getting a nice, comfortable lead down the third baseline. Scott. And time is called.
It's fogging up a little bit.
It'll be a 3-2 again from Baker. Hughes putting the pressure on in the set bat in the first inning, and the pitch is chopped foul again, as Pez just gets a piece of a slow breaking ball from Baker, and we will do it again. So it's Diebel, Scott, and Diebel away from their respective bags. The 3-2 coming from Baker. And ground ball to third. And Turner picks it cleanly. Throw over to first. And Nitt makes the play on the other end. And that will end the inning. So Redlands will get out of the inning, minimizing the damage. But Surfer is able to put two across. And we'll go to the top of the second. Blue Wave 2, Rays 1. Thank you. All right, back here in the top of the second, and it's going to be Kynan Melander leading it off for the Rays. Our SPBC TV maestro, John Reimers, has just gone to get a quick drink. So we'll be rocking with the wide angle cam for the time being, as Chambers just misses upstairs for ball one. So the Bluewave do a good job of working the pitch count of Griffin Baker, and we'll see if Redlands can return the favor with Chambers, as he again just misses upstairs, so 2-0. Chambers ready quickly, and the 2-0 is chopped towards third. Cosgrove makes the play, and the throw across for out number one. So first bit of action for Andy Cosgrove on the defensive side of the diamond. It'll be Beckham Crooks now for the Rays. Crooks 2-for-4 out of the 8-hole on Friday night. And now hitting the 9-hole. Chambers now 26 pitches, and that's number 27, and only 10 strikes. So he'll be looking to change that strike rate. As Crooks looks on at a 1-0, and fastball in there for strike one. Just a reminder to everyone watching the stream, we're gonna have at some point, Crooks grounds one towards third. Cosgrove comes in, an identical play and an identical outcome as he throws out Crooks for the second out. We're going to have Josh Warner, Surfers veteran and longtime reliever, as well as at some point Sam Foster, freshly crowned Division II champion Sam Foster, as well as longtime Division I member himself, joining the booth at various stages in the game. So if you have any questions for them or want to interact with them in any way, feel free to flick them across the chat. First pitch to Ryan Duncan is a strike. Duncan is 0-for-0 today. He walked on 4 pitches to lead off the game. And Chambers 1-1 now as the curveball misses high. And Duncan flies one into left field. Ricky Diebel drifts back, camps under it, and makes the catch. So a good quick inning, exactly what Steve Chambers needed. And we'll go to the bottom of the second with the Bluewave leading 2-1. All right, back here in the bottom of the second, it'll be Atsuki Takahashi to lead off. And as mentioned, we've got a special guest joining us for at least this half inning, if not as long as he'd like to stay. We've got freshly crowned Division II GBL champion, Sam Foster. Welcome, Sam.
Thanks, O. Good to be here. See if the boys can get it done here today.
So, question for you, Sammy, from a player perspective, and feel free to commentate, give us some insights about these guys, whatever you like. But looking at this team, as Takahashi chops one towards third, tough pick for Turner, nice play, and throws across to Nitt for the first out. Looking at the Blue Wave, so last year we had Connor O'Gorman, shout out Connor if you're watching. We had Scott Cronin, who was injured for most of this year, and you know, a couple of big bats that we had lost, and you know, ended up in the grand final even a step further than last year. What do you think has been the difference this year in terms of you know, the progress the team was still able to make?
Yeah, well, obviously, like you say, we lost a couple of big bats in the off season. Great to be able to retain the same imports with Andy and Jerry coming back. That's huge. I mean, to be able to have those guys back in the lineup. But I think the real big change is the young guys are stepping up. So Max Durrington and Harry White. I mean, the season that those two guys have had has really filled that hole for those bigger bats in the lineup. And I mean, even seeing here Andy hitting at leadoff spot, that's a kind of regular change that's come in this year. They played around early in the season with, you know, playing him Maxie leading off and Andy hitting two, and they've kind of got into a good groove now. And I think that Harry in particular has really embraced his role throughout the season, and Max at two, as you saw last inning, you know, can do some damage from that position as well.
Yeah, that's great insight. Tell us a little bit about, you know, I think regular viewers of the stream are very familiar with Andy Cosgrove and what he brings. I think Atsuki Takahashi is someone who may be a little newer to the, you know, newer to the team this year and kind of came up to Division I later on, and moving Kazi over to third base. Do you know anything about what went into that decision and sort of who was going to play short, who was going to play third?
Yeah, well, Atsuki started the season with us in Div 2, and it was partly due to the import rule and working out visas and that kind of thing.
As Cosgrove goes down swinging.
But to be honest, at the start of the season, preseason, when we had both squads together, and Atsuki came to the club, and he was slick, and everyone saw it straight away. Andy himself is like, I think we've got a new starting shortstop, you know. So when you got a guy like Andy kind of acknowledging that, he is silky smooth out there. He's got some of the best hands I've ever seen, and defensively, I think it gives us a lot more depth on that left side of the infield, you know. And Andy is, as you saw last inning, you know, he's super capable over there. There was a bit of a hole there midway through the season. At third base there, you know, trying to kind of fill in for Pez and Matty Hughes there. So I think it really strengthens the left side of the infield defensively, particularly.
As Durrington grounds one foul. So two quick outs here for Surfers in the bottom of the second. And what do you think the keys to today will be? I know, you know, from my perspective, I've seen these guys play against Griffin Baker a couple of times, and I think the times we've had success against him, we've done what we've done so far today, which is work his pitch count up and kind of get into that Redlands bullpen when Nitt's not available. Any commentary you have on Nitt's performance Friday, or what you're seeing from Baker, or what you think the boys should do differently tonight?
Yeah.
Look, Durrington takes one just outside.
Look, Reese is a veteran of the league. He's an established pitcher. He's always going to do that. And you know, it's no surprise to see him go nine innings and pitch the way he pitched. But the thing about Redlands is, once you get through that, then that's when some damage can be done. And I think we've got such a strong offensive lineup right through, you know, 1-9. That
Durrington swings through strike three. Go ahead, Sam. We'll finish that thought. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think you know, The key really was if we could have stolen a win on Friday night against Reese, that puts us in a really dominant position. Didn't go our way, but to be honest, like, now today is the day we got to jump on it. We got to jump on these guys, like you say, get to their bullpen. And I think just a general, the vibe I felt around the guys is they're not as intimidated by anything else they're going to throw at us. You know, Reese has a bit of an air about him that there's a bit of intimidation. The other good thing about that outcome on Friday night is he went 109 pitches So, I mean, that doesn't leave him a lot to, if he does pitch again on Tuesday, you know, we've got 70 pitches to get through.
Remind me, I think, is it 180 for the week?
It's 180 for the, in the final series. So, you know, all likelihood, knowing him, and he's a gamer, he's gonna put him, make himself available Tuesday. So I think we should assume that he's going to throw at some point on Tuesday, if we get there. So they've really got to capitalize today in particular, and then whoever else they throw on Tuesday, and try to get as many runs off those guys as they can.
Yeah, I think that's a great point, Sammy, because, I mean, Reese has 71 pitches left, but the way he threw on Friday, that might be six innings. Yeah. I mean, the way he can go when he needs to. So if the boys can get Baker out of this game early, I don't know if Erasmus is available today.
He's not today, apparently, but I think the assumption is he will start on Tuesday if they get there.
And try to get it to Nitt.
But, you know, the guys have also, the other thing against Nitty is the guys have all now seen him a lot on Friday. You know, he gets nine innings, they all got 3-4 at-bats against him. So, you know, he's coming into Tuesday with the guys with a bit better feel about it, how to approach him, you know, and I think that bodes well for Surface.
So we'll see Anthony Gomez here in the top of the third for Redlands, as Gomez takes one just downstairs. You think the weather's messing with these guys a little bit? Both pitchers kind of missing the zone a little, especially in the first inning.
Yeah, I think maybe the first inning just unsettled them a bit. I think Steve got into a bit of a groove last inning, though. Much better outing.
As Gomez pops on foul.
Where they can kind of disrupt your preparation too, when it's, you know, are we going to have a delayed start? Is it going to be interrupted game? Sometimes that can just get in your head a little bit.
As Gomez flies one into shallow right, it's Diebel and Hughes converging, and Diebel makes the play. A nice over-the-shoulder grab by Jai Diebel for the first out of the third.
Helps to have a part-time outfielder playing first base.
That's
well,
it.
Right?
That's it. Tell us a little bit more about the season you had, Sammy. So obviously, you know, skill set to play Div 1, chose to sort of play or coach Div 2 this year. You know, did you have fun? What went into the decision? All of that sort of thing.
Yeah, look, you know, it's a big commitment with life and work and all of that for starters. But to be honest, I also saw there was a lot of young guys coming through. You know, I knew Max was kind of right on the verge there, and yeah, Jake Calvers and these young guys coming through. And I didn't want to, at 40 this year, you know, I don't want to hold things up at A grade. And I've got a lot of the old veterans down there that in B grade that I knew I wanted to have fun. And I guess the thinking from a club perspective was we had an opportunity to have this perfect balance between half the team or some veterans who have been doing a long time, and then the other half of these young guys coming through who are not quite at that A grade level, but having a year with us.
This is the Div 2 team you're referring
to. Yeah, the Div 2 team. It gives them the perfect kind of springboard to get them ready and learn how to play Blue Wave baseball and get them ready for Div 1. So I think those guys have come a long way, those young guys.
As Zamora hits one high and fairly deep into right field, it's going to be Harry White camped under it, and he makes the catch for the second out.
Yeah, you know, those young guys, Lockie Jones, Jake Scott, Jake Calver, Wes Wilford, those guys from where they started at the beginning of the season to where they got to and to see how they performed, not only today, but throughout the second half of the season, they're like different ball players now, and I think that playing alongside some seasoned veterans like, you know, Shane Thompson and Matt Studeman and Luke White is you know, part of the reason for that.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I mean, you know, we just did the Div 2 game as first pitch to Ashby as a ball. We just did the Div 2 game, and just looking at the numbers from those guys, just 300 hitter this, 300 hitter that, extra bases, walking, you know, taking their walks and having good at-bats, and as Ashby takes ball two, just seeing that influence from the Sam Fosters and the Matt Studemans and the Shane Thompsons and the Luke Whites of the Div 2 level. And I think the scary thing for younger kids right now is these guys, You know, Sammy says he's 40. These guys look like they could play Div 2 until they're 60 and be perfectly competitive. So it might get a little crowded still, yeah. But it's just a question of which level. But, it, you know, I think, like you said, it bodes well for the Blue Wave. And, you know, we're not going to have Andy Cosgrove forever and yeah. Jerry Lacayo, and someone's going to have to step up and fill those roles.
You know, and good clubs, any sport, not just baseball, but any sport has depth. You know, the best clubs are the ones that have a really deep lineup, and right now the club is in a very healthy position because, you know, I played half a dozen games at Div 1 this year as well, and it was just like whatever's needed, there is someone there at every position who can jump in and fill in as needed across the club, and I think that is testament to we must be doing something right as a baseball club to be able to develop players and to have guys hang around.
As Ashby takes ball four, and he'll go down to first.
So yeah, I think you know, there's a real legacy at the club, and guys know that. The young guys are learning that now. They're learning. You know, I think it says something when you look at guys who have been. I played all my junior baseball at Surfers Paradise, and apart from, mind you, I did play for Redlands.
Okay. In grade, a fact I did not know.
Yeah, yeah. So I've played for both these teams out here.
So Sammy Foster wins either way this yeah. weekend. As Pike lines one into center field, Durrington coming on and makes the catch. And that will do it for the top of the third.
But, you know, that was something that I missed out as a junior. You know, part of the reason I went and played at Redlands is at that time... we didn't have an under 18 team that was playing in the Brisbane League. They were only playing in the Gold Coast League. So myself and Brad Wiseman played up here at Windsor at our junior 16s and 18s to get better competition. And then we didn't have a GBL team for a surface in those years. So if you wanted to play at this level, you had to go and play for other clubs. So I had a season, I couldn't get into the Windsor A grade lineup. I was playing, representing Queensland and Australia, and playing at under 18s here, but they wouldn't give me a shot. So I went and I played my junior baseball here at Windsor, and then I had a season at Indians.
Okay.
With some great guys, and to my point earlier about learning from veterans, you know, I was playing on a team with David Foxover, Phil Overlack, Stevie Ryder. Cooper Cronk, who went to rugby league, obviously, and Daniel Thompson, and you know, David Byler. We had an awesome team, and I learned so much from those older guys in those years. And then I had a year at Redlands with some veteran guys. My brother played there, and Wardy,
that's
and
right.
a bunch
yep.
of us. We went to Redlands before we had our GBL team. And so, you know, you got to do what you got to do as a young player, and you want to play at the highest level possible. And that's like these young guys that are coming through now through our club. They're all on the bench down there. They played with us in Div 2 and they hang around. And they've done that all season. They've been great team club contributors because they've done what we've needed them to do at Div 2 and then come in at Div 1 whenever Kevy needs them and contributed throughout the year. So
that's it. It's a culture here. It's good. It's been, you know, my time here, I've only been here 3-4 years, but seeing us go from sort of at the Div 1 level, relatively mediocre, to the sort of the breakout it's been the last couple of years with, obviously, you know, Andy, Jerry, AJ Fell, shout out AJ if you're watching, some of the American imports being big parts of that, but also, like you said, the young kids who have developed and learned under the wing of some of these sort of surfers legends. Well, as Diebel takes ball one.
Look at a guy like Harry White who's on deck here, you know. Harry White, young guy at the club, had kind of struggled a little bit last year. He started the season in Div 2 with us and was kind of on that fringe of playing Div 1. And then he ends up leading did he lead the league in homers?
Yeah, he did. Yeah, 9 home runs, clear by 2 over second place, yeah.
So, you know, that's a massive turnaround. And
we spoke a bit, as Jai Diebel takes ball 3, we spoke a bit about Harry in the Div 2 Div 2 stream about how
maybe it should be a podcast, Johnny. Maybe that's the next step.
About how he
you're going to be the co-host, yeah. I'll tell you that.
How Harry was on the mound at the end of the Div 2 final, as Diebel takes a 4-pitch walk, on the mound at the end of the Div 2 final 2 years ago when Redlands came back and had a win. So a tough loss that I'm sure you know, Harry hung on to for a little while, knowing him, and then came back and played an awesome, awesome game in the Division II final last year. And I think because he wasn't a part of that final inning where we had the comeback victory, it gets
just
forgotten.
Just remind us again, Al, who won that
game? I had
game?
To remind us in addition that I just happened to be
as much as he wants.
I happened to be the last one of many to get a hit in that inning, yes. But
and funnily enough, we repeated in exactly the same way through the hole.
A catcher walk-off in the five hole to win the Div 2 title. That's back-to-back years. So shout out Lachlan Jones for taking up the mantle there. But Harry had a huge game, and he had a couple of hits in that game, couple of two-out RBIs. He had a great play in right field to hold a runner at third as he takes up and in. And then just, you know, it's a confidence builder. You win a title, and kid puts his work in the gym, and all of a sudden he's exploded this year, you know?
Yeah, I mean, he's a big, strong, athletic kid, and I think the thing for Harry is he's just got to, it's all between the ears with him, you know, really. If he's relaxed and confident, he plays really well. Sometimes he can be his own worst enemy, and I think, you know, he knows that about himself, and when he's in a good headspace and nice and calm, he can really do damage to a baseball.
Yeah,
I'm gonna call it right here. I think he's got one in him right here.
So that's it, Sammy Foster. Calling the two-run homer right here.
Oh,
just underneath it, as White skies it on the infield for Reese Knitt, who gets underneath it and puts it away for the first out of the inning.
Only centimeters away from the middle of the barrel.
So it'll be Jerry Lacayo now coming to the plate for Surfers.
Jerry's been hot all year. I mean, he talked about a good hitter who's like just a smart hitter. I think, you know, just in those situations, I guess that thing being a catcher as well, but he's played so much baseball in so many leagues all around the world. Mm-hmm. He's such a, you know, still a young guy, but such a veteran, really. His experience comes through, and I think everyone feels that, and he's a really cool head at the plate.
As Diebel takes off for second, Lacayo swings and fouls it back. Yeah, I think Jerry comes from my understanding of baseball family. I don't remember the exact details, but I think his family's involved in running a league out in Colorado. He's talked about that in the past, and, you know, Jerry does a lot with the young kids at the club too, you know, teaching lessons and doing some coaching, and the young kids love this guy, look up to him. So.
Yeah, and every time he's come out here, he's done the same thing, and he's, you know, he's the first guy at training and the last guy to leave, and he's coaching young kids in the cages as everyone's leaving training on a Wednesday night, and, you know, it's great to see.
As Lacayo takes upstairs, count goes to 1-1 here.
And he's one of those guys, he just loves baseball. He just genuinely loves baseball, and he can see it, and that's why he's chasing opportunities all over the world, as he should. And I know he was trying to line up a gig in Germany after this season finishes, so fingers crossed he can get that happening.
That's it. Whatever German league Jerry is trying to play for, if you're listening now, give him a look, 100%.
Make sure you subscribe to the channel.
Yeah.
So 2-1 now on Lacayo. That was Baker's 60th pitch, only 28 strikes to this point. No action at this stage in the Rays bullpen. We did see Oscar Hyde up in the first, but as Baker had a relatively smoother second inning, haven't seen any action as of yet. And Lacayo takes upstairs. We'll go to 3-1.
I think they if they can put another couple of runs on here, that could shake things up for the Rays. And actually, I understand Bobby walking in now, Bobby Erasmus. So maybe
got the emergency call.
Yeah, I did hear a rumor that he was only available after 4 due to work commitments. So that's amateur baseball for you. It's come when you finish your shift. But that could change things. I don't know if this game gets tight and they think they can lock it down and win it today. They might flip it to him, but then that means that it kind of leaves him short for Tuesday. So we'll see.
Do you know if those same rules still apply, Sammy? If he's under 45 pitches, can he go again on Tuesday, or if it's just the 180 and just use it how you like, or do we know about?
I believe it's 180. However you want.
Diebel takes off on the 3-2, and Lacayo flies it deep to left, but foul.
Yeah, I'd have to check. Maybe there's some differences with the final series, but my understanding is that it's 180 over 3 games.
I'd have to check that as well. I don't know if for for the over 20s, if there's any specific rules on the night to night, if it's the same as last year, or if it's just like you said, the 180. So, but I agree with your take. If Redlands thinks they've got this game locked down late, they're going to do whatever they can to prevent it from going to Tuesday. So
yeah, and I think we're in a similar position with Declan, to be honest.
That's Declan Summerford, for those who aren't familiar, as Lakeo takes ball four, and Surfer's now in a little bit of business here with first and second and one away.
Just talking to him on the way up here, actually, and what the plan is for today is, you know, if it gets close, obviously we have to win this game, so depending on how Stevie goes, if it gets close, they're going to flip it to Dex, but in an ideal world, we save him for Tuesday, you know, get it done and not have to use him, and then he would have the start on Tuesday night, probably.
And that suited him last week, as he was absolutely electric on Tuesday night last week, Declan Summerford. So it's Ricky Deeble now with Jai Deeble away from second, and courtesy runner Jake Scott in again at first for Lakeo. One out here in the bottom of the third. Surfer's already leading 2-1 and threatening for more.
He seems to be struggling to find it here. He's the Surfer should be patient in the box here. He's kind of all around the zone, and good time to see a couple of pitches, I reckon. Mm.
And Ricky Deeble has been, as he takes strike one, has been patient, as we noted last at bat. His on-base percentage quite high in this postseason. 8 walks already through the couple of postseason series, including his last at bat, last plate appearance. Scott Cronin on deck, always a power threat. And pitches in there, strike two to Deeble. So that's 67 pitches now for Baker.
Something right side for Ricky here.
Just to move the runner over. Gaps on both sides of the infield. Big slow curveball, and he's called out on strikes. Deeble not happy with the call, thinking it was probably above the zone.
Yeah, it looked a little high, I have to say. That's,
and it looks like Cronin may be offering his opinion as well, as he steps in. You have that up, Sammy?
Potentially? Yeah, it's hard from this angle, but it looked like it's didn't drop into the zone quite enough for me. But
always tough, those big breakers, where they cross the plate versus where the catcher receives them, as Cronin fouls one back.
Cronin swinging at the first pitch. Surprise, surprise. He doesn't have the nickname Trigger for no reason. He's going to be aggressive. I mean, that's the thing, you know. He's going to go for it. He's just got to be patient here. Probably going to see an off-speed pitch, I'd say, here. Struck him out on an off-speed pitch last at bat.
As Cronin grounds one foul past third. Yeah, I have to imagine that Baker's strategy here with Cronin is just slow, slow, and slower. But we'll see if he tries to mix it up.
I don't think he's got enough zip to get it by most of these better hitters in the Bluewave lineup. So I think the strategy is going to be to mix it up and keep him on front foot, keep him guessing. Mm.
So 0-2 here, and there it is, the big slow curveball at 66. And Cronin just gets a piece. It's these little things, though, like we said on Friday night with Nitt being so economical through his 9. These little things, these extra foul balls, Matt Hughes getting an 8 or 9 pitch at bat, even though he didn't end up knocking any runs in. Yeah. That's big for Surfers. You got guys at the bottom of the order seeing pitches and making Baker work here.
Yeah, and obviously Scotty Cronin's a threat still, you know, like to have him sitting here in the 7 hole and,
of course,
and still put the ball out here and change the game.
And Cronin takes downstairs, count to 1 and 2 now.
And that's the thing, you know, when you got a bat like this to be, and Scotty's obviously had an injury interrupted season, but now that he's back healthy, to be able to drop him into the lineup, and it's still a threat, you know, this in the bottom half of the lineup, that's it's definitely been playing their mind. They don't want to miss here to him.
Yeah.
He could change the game very quickly right here with one swing.
Absolutely. This is a guy who people may forget a couple of years ago hit about, as Cronin swings through strike 3, but it's going to go to the backstop. Cronin racing up towards first, and no play for Ashby. So an unfortunate lack of bounce off that brick wall prevents Ashby from making any play, and all of a sudden, Blue Wave have the bases loaded here and get a free out for Matt Hughes.
Again.
Again.
Pez coming up with second time in three innings that Pez is going to come up to the plate with loaded bases.
So Hughes getting an opportunity here to contribute after sitting down on Friday. You know anything about, it seems like the last couple of weeks the plan has been to platoon Hughes and Wilfred on the Friday-Sunday. And I don't know what goes into the decision on Tuesday or not, if you can shed any light on that, or if it's just sort of whoever plays better that weekend, or...
Look, you know, finals baseball, you got to put your best team out there, and you got to go on performance, and, you know, Pez was struggling a little bit this season, and Wilfred is, you know, he's a strong hitter and can plug that hole there, so... But, you know, Pez has contributed throughout the year, so he gets his chance today, and I think he'll be keen to make that count and show that he can still contribute, and that might impact who plays on Tuesday.
As Hughes takes upstairs for ball one. So for those who don't know, Matt Hughes, colloquially known as Pez around the club. My understanding is it has to do with looking like a Pez dispenser at times, but perhaps you can give us the full detail.
In particular during hacky sessions, which has become a big part of the surface culture, which I have to tell you that I was the one who introduced hacky to Surface Paradise many, many years ago.
As Hughes takes ball two upstairs.
Probably 20 years ago, I came to the club when we were playing our... won one of our earlier titles in about 2003-2004, and I pulled out a hacky sack one day at training, and the boys are looking at me like a weird hippie that I am, and it's now cottoned on and become folklore at Surface Paradise.
As Hughes grounds one up the middle, Baker knocks it down, and he'll race over to first and make the toss to Nip. And so nothing doing there for Surfers after threatening, but they make Baker work, and we'll go to the fourth still leading 2-1.
So yeah, the hacky was introduced as a pre-game. I remember the final that we won here at Windsor. We were they were all doing their run-throughs down the line, taking it all very serious. And 5 minutes before the first pitch, we're playing hacky sack down, like laughing and carrying on. And then came out to win that final. And you know, that kind of speaks to the attitude and the relaxed nature. You know, I'm a big believer that if you relax, and there's that kind of sweet spot where if you're focused but you're relaxed, you're going to perform at your best, right? I know at times I've gotten too tight on that last
tension.
Sunday. Yeah, when I played last Sunday, I felt, you know, there was a lot of emotion in that game with everything that had been going on off the field, and I think you know, you just tighten up a little bit, you kind of do things that you wouldn't normally do, and I think that's a big part of it.
My so shift is done, it looks like.
The booth continues to grow here as
getting a bit busy
going into the bottom of the fourth, we've got none other than Surfers longtime reliever Josh Warner joining the squad.
Thanks, Sammy.
Hey, thanks for having me, boys.
Looks like Sammy's on his way out, so we really appreciate your time with the booth.
Up.
And we'll just swap it out for Josh here. So, Josh, welcome to the booth.
Thank you, gents. Looking forward to being up here.
High, Josh.
Good view from up here. It's
a
setup.
A good view. Yeah.
It's nice and dry as well, which is always always handy.
This booth is slowly turning into the Braves when they have John Smoltz and Chipper Jones, and all of a sudden all the players
everybody
just
wants to be there.
Having a laugh and, you know, kind of calling the game in between. So we'll see how we go.
Don't know who's going to walk in the door next.
Yeah. So Josh, why don't you, as Dan Turner steps to the plate here for Redlands, it'll be Turner to be followed by Nitt as Chambers looks in for his fourth inning of work. The first pitch from Turner flied into center field fairly deep. Darrington settles underneath it and makes the catch for out number one.
Safe as houses, Maxie, safe as houses.
So Josh, why don't you start, just give us some of the younger viewers, especially a little bit of your baseball background. I know some of it, but not all of it. Sort of your journey and how you've been kind of a part of Surfers throughout the whole experience.
Yeah, when I was a bit younger, I was fortunate enough to sign with the Phillies when I was 18. Spent 4 seasons over there playing professional, trying to work through the ranks, and unfortunately in that fourth season I had shoulder surgery. Came back here and played a couple of years of ABL. Took a couple of years off, just a little break, as I've been a bit burnt out from training and playing. As Nitty pops up here to the shortstop, but Andy looks like he's taking it. little ball hog over there, Andy, but that's all good. Abs didn't want a bar of it. But no, I took a couple of years off and thought, you know, I do love the game and I miss it a bit. So decided to come back and was fortunate enough that Canberra were happy to have me in the ABL for a few seasons. And now I'm just happy to be back part of the Blue Wave and trying to get a championship.
That's it. That's it. So as you all can hear, between the combination of Reimers, myself, and Warner, we have significant amount of professional experience.
About 4 years worth.
About 4 years worth between Warner's 4 years and you know, my time in Little League in the U.S. and that sort of thing, as Melander takes one in. We got two quick outs here. The scoreboard's just a little bit behind here. And what do you see? You know, we asked Sammy about this and would love to get your take as well. Just the team this year is sort of taking a step forward, even having lost, you know, effectively Scott Cronin for most of the year before coming back from injury, having lost O'Gorman as he moved away, some of the big bats in this lineup. You know, so, talk to us about how the young kids have stepped up and sort of the changes that had to be made there.
Yeah, it's been massive. The boys have really stepped up this year. And
as Melander chops one towards shortstop, Atsuki Takahashi with the pick and goes across to Diebel. So a quick inning for Chambers, who has really settled in after his first inning. And we'll go to the bottom half of the fourth, 2-1 Surfers.
Yeah, so no, the young kids especially, Wes, for instance, he's come up real big all year. I think he struggled a bit early on. I wasn't here for the first part of the season. But from my understanding, him and Zach both had a bit of a chance to play second base and take a few ABs and didn't quite measure up, which is fine. They're young and that's kind of expected, just to test the waters. Then we had Matt Hughes come in and do what he's been doing for the last few years and fill in spots where he needs to, playing between second and third and really quite solid. And then towards the end of the year, Matt Hughes' bat just didn't quite light up, and we got Wes back in here and he really just cemented his spot with taking some good solid ABs, solid contact, and really making sure he's pretty well a wall there at second base. So it's been really good to see some of these young guys step up and then really compliment having Andy and Atsuki and Jerry. Having these older guys in the field and some young guys like Maxi Darrington in center field has been a real solid piece of that outfield unit. And all the young boys have really stepped up this year and has made it tough for the other team to pitch to us 1-9, really. Usually, I think for the last couple of seasons, we've had a little bit of a gap there in that 7-8-9 spot. But now we've got a pretty solid lineup 1-9, and it makes it really hard for the opposing pitchers to really get comfortable up there. Mm.
So give us a little insight, and just kind of, you can take this wherever you like it, but you know, we know you're a well-established pitcher in this league and have been in other leagues, and you know, between Chambo and Baker and what they're doing today, what you're seeing from them, whether you think they're struggling with command, whether it's the weather or some nerves or anything else, and maybe also how you would attack these lineups, anything like that, even some thoughts from Friday night that you might have had, whatever you'd like to go on about in that regard.
Yeah, I mean, these weather conditions are never easy. And
there it is, Takahashi right up the middle as Gomez looks like he slipped making a movement out there. And this is the concern about playing wet baseball, is you don't want anyone getting hurt on something silly. But a single up the middle for Takahashi to start the Surfers fourth.
Yeah, these conditions are never easy. As a pitcher, you want command of all your pitches, and when the ball's slick like that, you're guessing sometimes up there. Sometimes if there's a little bit too much water on either one of the fingers, it just comes out not how you expect it. And having someone like Chambers, who's got a lot of experience, who's played a lot, having him on the mound like that in a situation like this is really ideal.
As Cosgrove pulls a bunt back that almost hits him.
Just because he's got that experience where he understands, all right, I don't need to throw it 100% here. If I can dial it back a little and have 90% but control of my pitches, I'm still going to be effective. And in a grand final when the adrenaline's running, it's really hard to do that. So the experience really steps up there. And he obviously struggled in the first with that adrenaline, but he's settled in here and is able to.
As Cosgrove laces one into left field, and Duncan makes the catch running on. Atsuki Takahashi back to first.
But it's been good to see both of them. Obviously, I don't know Baker very well, but he seems to have settled in a bit here too. The rain's eased off, which makes him feel more comfortable as well. But yeah, it's been good to see Chambo settle down a little and get to work.
So you went 4 2/3 on Friday night, and I know your role has been a little bit different this postseason than it has maybe in the past, where you're sort of one inning, two inning, kind of blow the doors down guy. And I actually should apologize publicly on the chat because I made some comments about your pitches saying that you hadn't thrown a fastball yet. And I was corrected by Josh, for everyone out there, that a couple of those 76, 77 mile an hour pitches were fastballs, which for some of you young kids out there, you end up getting a 76, 77, that's great. But for a guy that used to throw 92, I could be forgiven, hopefully, for that mistake. And on that note, we've got a question here from Ben Morris in the chat, and we'll kind of keep it clean on the stream here, but he's basically wanting to know how your arm felt after Friday night.
Yeah, look, I'm still struggling to do that, Benny. You know how it is. So still on Sunday, I rolled it over warming up, and yeah, it didn't feel good. We'll leave it at that, but I try to do my left hand with everything at the moment.
So shout out to Benny Morris and Ollie Morris if you're on the stream. I'm not sure if you're in class or oh no, it's Sunday. Hey, so Ollie, you're probably watching as well.
Where were we with the...
Just pitching, yeah, what these guys are facing, how you'd attack these lineups. Oh, yeah, commentary on Chambo if you'd like.
I mean, I have been a guy that's been one or two innings, mostly because my arm just hasn't held up to a point that I've been able to throw multiple innings together. Some of you, if you're watching the Friday night game against Pine Rivers a week ago, I gave up a pretty deep fly ball to center field.
As Durrington grounds one towards second, play at second for one, but Durrington too quick. And so two away now as Debo will come to the plate.
And I gave up that pretty deep fly ball to center field, and Kevy comes out to see me on the mound, and he realized that the ball might not have been as firm as Owen has graciously allowed everyone to understand how slow the ball's been coming in. But he comes out and goes, "Are you okay, Josh?" I was like, "Well, no, Kev, I've been hurt all year, but my arm the way it is, and I'm not really maintaining it very well at the moment. It just, some days it's good and some days it's bad." And on Friday night, I was lucky enough to get past the pain, and it started to feel a bit better towards the end. But I just like to be out there and compete irrespective of how we go, how it's feeling. But in terms of these Rays hitters, I haven't really faced them at all this year. I had one outing against them, and that was a short one. Steve threw 7 shutout innings in that game, so he left the work very short, which is nice.
Steve will foul one back, count to 0-2 now.
But for me, one of my most effective pitches is a sinker in, so to a right-handed hitter. So I pretty much try to stick to my strengths wherever I can. I don't typically like to pitch around guys and try to pitch to their weaknesses. So I'll stick hard in with the sinker and hard away with the sinker to a lefty, and that seems to be quite effective. And then I've got that slider there when I need it. And I feel like I'm pretty confident with throwing that pitch. So they're my two key weapons, and then I've obviously got a four-seam and a curveball.
Excellent. And talk to us a bit about your thoughts on Nitt's performance Friday night. We've talked about that a little bit with Sammy as well. And, you know, we saw the boys sort of jumping on fastballs early. And unfortunately, you know, until Jai Debo got a hold of one in the eighth, we didn't see any fruit from that. What are your thoughts on sort of the balance as Debo strikes out to end the surfer's fourth? Your thoughts on the balance between trying to jump an early fastball that Nitt might be just trying to get over and then worrying about trying to work his pitch count up, and how you sort of balance those two objectives?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard from my perspective, not being a hitter. Sometimes I like to think I am, but I'm definitely not. From what the hitters were saying, I try to listen to what they're saying when they come in after each at bat, and they're saying they were finding it hard under the lights here to pick up the spin on his slider. So what that means is that if they're getting that first pitch fastball, they want to kind of get to that, because they know if they get later in the at bat, then if the slider comes out, they've really not got much hope of hitting it if they're struggling to see the spin there. So we know that it was going 120 pitches no matter what. Typically, that's an 8 or 9 inning performance, and especially when you're swinging first pitch, it's definitely going to pretty much guarantee that 9 innings. But at the end of the day, we've been a strong hitting team all year, and we don't want to shy away from our strengths just to try to choose some pitches or anything like that. We want to get out there and do what we can do. And yeah, luckily enough, Deeb's got to him in the eighth there to make it closer, and we couldn't quite hold him out there in the ninth. But yeah, it's one of those things again. I think you stick to your strengths where you can, especially when somebody's got a full pitch count. If we make it through to Tuesday and he pitches again, we know he's only got about 60 pitches. So it might be a bit of a different approach that night to get him out in the third or fourth. But for a game where you know he's going the full length, it's just get out and do what we can do to score some runs.
So we'll go to the top of the fifth here now. Surfer still clinging to a 2-1 lead. And it'll be Beckham Crooks out of the nine hole for Redlands, and then back around to the top.
And this inning will be key right here, I think, with Chambers getting to the third time through the lineup, I believe. So after this nine hole up, we've got our leadoff guy who's now seen Chambers twice.
That's right.
So it'll be really interesting to see how Chambers does, and he'll probably mix his pitches up a little bit more here, knowing that they've seen him a couple times, and he'll remember those ABs. So he'll try to pitch around and keep them guessing a little bit. Whereas you have somebody like Dex who obviously throws that upper eights, low nines. And you pretty much know what you're going to get with him. You're going to get some hard stuff 80% of the time. But Chamber knows that he's got to mix it up. So I'm really excited to see how he attacks these hitters, and hopefully he can keep them off balance.
Yeah, it's always fun to watch. I remember the times I was fortunate enough to get a chance to catch Steve was always a pleasure. And just like I said earlier in the stream, typically pinpoint accuracy, so a little bit uncharacteristic today, as right on cue, Crooks takes a four-pitch walk to start the inning, and it'll be back to Duncan at the top. But yeah, always thinking out there, always trying to be one step ahead, and very collected as well. You don't see a lot of emotion from him, not too high, not too low, and a pleasure to work with. He's now at 55 pitches. Chambers, after a busy first inning, not a bad place to be here in the top of the fifth.
Yeah, the pitch count's obviously a big one in terms of how you're feeling up there, but another thing that a lot of people don't necessarily take into account is it's the ups and downs. So it's the rest in between innings which really can put a toll on your arm a little bit. Even though he's only thrown 55 and you think, oh, he's got a lot to go, it's sitting down, and if there's long innings in between, that's when your body starts to really cool off, and it's hard to pick it up in that beginning of the inning. Hopefully with a runner on here, he can get some adrenaline back and work the count here. But no, Chambers, he's a vet. We all know what he's capable of, and I wouldn't want anybody else out on the bump at the moment.
As Chambers throws over and Crooks is back, we talked a little bit on Friday night watching you about, and all jokes about the fastball aside, about you when you got guys on sort of turning the dial a little, seeming like you had a little bit more in reserve, and do you think that's something we'd likely see from Steve later in this game if needed?
Yeah, it's one thing I think you don't respect enough when you're younger is you're 100% every time when you're younger, but when you get a bit older and you understand that, you know, it doesn't take max effort to get guys out, it takes well-located pitches and mixing it up, so you definitely start to understand that an 80% fastball and 100% fastball are two completely different pitches. And if you can roll one in at 80% at the beginning of that bat and then you dial it up that extra 20% at the end, that's going to keep the hitters off balance just as much as an off-speed pitch. So you can start to really use your pitches effectively by mixing up the speeds of each pitch. Yeah. And I don't think young kids really understand that enough. And that's just experience. So the older you get, they call it crafty for a reason, because you can turn two or three pitches that you have in your arsenal into six pitches because you're just varying the speeds.
As Duncan flies one into shallow left, it's Ricky Diebel underneath as Crooks is not tagging and back to first. Diebel makes the catch, and that'll be one away and bring up Anthony Gomez.
Something I can see from up here, it makes it a bit easier, is those batter's boxes seem to be quite muddy. So I think the one thing the hitters are going to probably struggle with a bunch, like, is that front foot when it steps down. If they've got too much mud under their cleats, it's going to be really hard to stay balanced. Mm. So yes, the pitchers have it tough with the wet, but the hitters have it a bit tough too. So it's one thing to keep in mind. And as a pitcher, if you can get them leaning forward on out in front, then that keeps them off balance, especially with the mud.
As Gomez grounds one under the glove of Cosgrove in the left field, Beckham Crooks rounds, and he'll get into third, and Gomez is going to go to second. Ricky Diebel with a slight bobble out there, but likely didn't change the outcome. And so probably a double for Gomez, who's had himself a nice series.
Yeah, that one's tough there. Andy, Andy's a guy that you just think's a brick wall back there. So missing that one, it's tough. It was a hard play, obviously, and you can't expect your players to get it. But when you got somebody as high caliber as Andy at third base, you as a pitcher, you go, oh, we've got this. Mm. And to see it go through to the outfield would have been a bit hard there for Steve. But we've got a one-run lead here, and Chambers understands that. So giving up one here is okay if it's a sack fly, but you don't want to be giving up a base hit and potentially the lead. So Chambers will work out what he can here. The infield is staying back to make sure a one out, and hopefully we can minimize damage here.
And to those who couldn't quite see it on the stream, I'm not sure how quick the camera turned as Zamora takes strike one. Not an error by Cosgrove by any means, but just a hesitation step. Wasn't sure which way to attack sort of the hop, as it looked like it might have been kind of in between, and then had to dive backwards and just kind of went under his glove. So,
yeah, it was a tough play. You can't expect it to be made there. Ball went under his glove. It was hit pretty hard. He had to dive for it.
As Zamora chops one out towards the mound, Crooks steps off of third, but then goes back, and Chambers, after looking him back, flips over to Diebel. So a nice job by Steve Chambers there to keep the runners in check, and we've now got two away, and it falls to Kai Ashby to try and take advantage of the situation, with Redlands threatening with second and third, and Surfers clinging to a one-run lead here in the fifth.
And that's one difference I think our team has above the rest of the competition for the most part is that we got some really solid base runners. We made some silly mistakes throughout the year, but we've got speed and we're aggressive on the bases. And I think in a similar situation there, I think we're just going when you see that soft contact. But the little hesitation there, Steve checking in and seeing what he's doing, was enough to keep him there. And they're the big plays in big games that really make a difference. It's those little one percenters and the 50-50 calls that can really turn a game around.
That's it. I think as Chambers drops a big curveball in for strike one, I think if Crooks takes off immediately, obviously hindsight's 20/20, but if Crooks takes off immediately, that's a very tough play for Steve Chambers to make, going towards first base there to pivot and throw him out at home. I think, on the other hand, you got Max Durrington out there at third, and we saw the way he ran the bases in the first inning. I think he's safe 9 times out of 10 at home doing that if he breaks first movement. So.
Yeah, look, I think with Steve running away from home plate, I think he goes to first no matter what there. So off the bat, I think he concedes that and takes the out, but we're lucky enough that a little slip up there, and hopefully Steve can make the most of it and keep it to a big zero on the inning.
And pitches right on the outside edge for strike two. Ashby not a huge fan of the call.
Yeah, one thing I see with Ashby, he didn't really take many swings at my off-speed pitch on Friday night. So he took some nice healthy swings on the heater, but I think I caught him looking on a slider away. So I think Chambers should go off-speed again here, and hopefully down in the zone and get a swing over the top. There, cutter away he went there.
Yeah, it went away with the cutter there. And I would say Steve suffering from the same thing that Josh Warner suffered from me on Friday night, where when the velo is not quite at 100%, a little harder for me to identify the pitches, but we do our best up here.
Yeah, I'll give you benefit of the doubt. The angle up here is not great, and it's hard to tell. I'll give you the benefit of the doubt. And when you see 77 come up, you definitely don't think that's a heater for the most part.
Perhaps, so. Yeah, not from you guys as Ashby fouls one back. Yeah, look, it's been generally lower velocity today from the guys. Baker's been 76 to 79 with the fastball. Stevie right around the same. We'll see what we get from the guys out of the pen. As you know, we know the Blue Wave have a couple of flamethrowers. Talk to us a little bit about that. Doug Breeze's development as a reliever. Matt Boyce has really settled into sort of a bulldog late innings role. What have you seen from those guys? Big spot from Steve That's Chambers huge. Getting the strikeout. And there's some of that emotion we don't often see from Steve, but a grand final situation and getting out of the inning there. Get a little bit of letting loose from Steve Chambers.
Goosebumps, boys.
That's it.
Big. That's big time right there.
And Ashby as well, showing some emotion, some frustration, slamming his bat in disgust at chasing the pitch that Josh Warner predicted for us 2 pitches earlier. So we'll go to the bottom of the fifth with a 2-1 Surfers lead.
Yeah, I won't stay up here much longer, but just to touch on that point with our bullpen, I think that's been one of our strongest points all year is the depth that we have in arms in the bullpen. Like you said, Dougie Breeze, he used to be a position player, he's decided to move towards the role on the bump, and he can really get it up there. And like you said, we got Boise, who struggled with some command earlier in the season from my understanding, but he's really come in tight situations and really come up with the goods. And obviously we all know Dex all year, he's just been the workhorse for our game one starter, or at least starting one of the games all year. And for a guy to just come out week on week and just put solid 5, 6, 7 inning performances in, and he's really carried the pitching staff all year. We as a team, we feel confident with our pitching staff. We know it's the best in the league, and we think if we've got a lead going towards the end of the game, that we've got a really good chance to get the W. So hopefully our bats can extend that lead a little here, because obviously at Windsor, you never really know what's going to happen. The ball seems to fly a little bit here, and hopefully our bats can do the job and give us a bit of cushion. But I'll leave Owen to it. I got to get back to the dugout and cheer the boys on. But
excellent.
Hopefully we can get the job done today.
Well, thank you for joining us, Josh. You're always welcome in the booth. Really appreciate the insights.
Thanks.
Good stuff. And good luck the rest of today, and hopefully on to Tuesday.
Yep.
So that's Josh Warner joining us after Sam Foster. Big ups to both of those guys. Thank you so much. We really enjoyed your input. And it's Baker back out now for the bottom of the fifth, and he will face surfers 4, 5, and 6, beginning with Harry White. And just having another look at the chat here as John Reimers has stepped away briefly again, so we'll stick with the wide angle. Benny, appreciate the update on Ollie. Best of luck to Ollie. I believe it's Paris University Club, if I remember right, that both Ollie and Benny are playing for. And we miss you guys down here. Looking forward to seeing you whenever we get a chance. As Harry White takes ball one. And ball's in the dirt for ball two. So Chambers does a brilliant job to work out a trouble there. And through five innings has thrown 69 pitches, 36 for strikes. And still managing to cling to a one-run lead here. Griffin up into the 90s with his pitch count. And definitely some movement in the Redlands bullpen. Unclear who's going to throw. It looks like Hyde getting up again, the young lefty from the Rays. As we mentioned before, it looks like Erasmus has arrived as well. Another strong reliever out of the Rays bullpen, as Harry White takes a big lash at a high fastball and just fouls it back. Crook's fairly deep out and right. The other two outfielders playing Harry White straight up. Griffin now at 92 pitches. And big slow breaking ball in there for strike two. So it'll be a 2-2 now to the surfer's cleanup hitter. And swinging a hard line drive up the middle, that's going to dunk in for a base hit. So Harry White aboard with a leadoff single. And that'll bring up Jerry Lacayo, the veteran surfers catcher. We talked about this Friday night, Jerry Lacayo, part of the team when the surfers Division I side won their last grand final about 6 years ago. Takes his time, gets his eyes locked in, now digs in. Baker, who was ready to go, now steps off. So a little bit of cat and mouse here with Harry White away from first in the bottom of the fifth. And fouled back to the screen. So Lacayo showing bunt here, drawing Turner in. And we'll see where the Redlands infield lines up. So you got Nitt holding White on at first. And as of now, Turner about even with the bag. We did see some good defense from Turner earlier today, and he is sparkling with the glove over there at third base in general. Lacayo pretty quick for a catcher. And Harry White averaged to slightly above average speed at first. And Lacayo showing bunt again. Push bunt towards the first base side, and it's going to be a race to the bag, which Baker will win. But a nice job from Lacayo to get the bunt down. and doing the right thing there with a lefty on the mound, which means he's falling off towards third base when he releases the pitch. A nice job by Lacayo to do a push bunt. And the goal there would have been, if he could get it past Baker, to potentially be looking at a hit, because it's a difficult play for the second baseman or first baseman if they all start to sort of convene on that ball to get Lacayo at first. But either way, the sacrifice gets the job done. That brings Ricky Diebel to the plate. And Diebel down, pitches down in the dirt. Nice job by Ashby to make the block. And Harry White will stay at second base. Diebel 0 for 1 with a walk today. And Lacayo credited with a ground out there, so potentially a little mistake in the scorebook, as that would have been a sacrifice bunt. Griffin Baker on 97 pitches. It'll be the 98th coming to Ricky Diebel. With Hyde still getting loose in the pen. As Diebel chops one towards short, so it's going to be a tough play for Gomez. Comes in, makes the throw, and throw is offline and unable to reach Ricky Diebel on the swipe tag, and he will reach. We'll see how they score it. It would have been a tough play, and Nitt did his best to put the swipe tag on, but Diebel was already past him. And so now first and third, one out. And we'll see what the Blue Wave do with Diebel on first and a lefty on the mound, whether they take a chance at looking for the double steal here and preventing any sort of double play, or whether they let Cronin do his job with the bat. Nitt not holding Diebel on at first, so potentially yielding the stolen base. And Diebel does take off first pitch. Ashby with the fake. And no throw. So second and third, now the double play eliminated as Cronin takes strike one. And a big spot here for the Blue Wave. Baker checks the runners, now comes set. And the 0-1 is breaking ball in the dirt. Ashby keeps it in front. Nice job by the Rays catcher. So Cronin's been out in front of the breaking pitch from Baker all day long. We'll see if Baker sticks with the breaker and if Cronin's able to make the adjustment. 1-1 coming. And breaking ball down, again blocked by Ashby. 2-1 now on Cronin. If Cronin were to reach, if Kevin Fenn has shown his hand early, it looks like it'll be Wes Wilford, pinch hitting for Hughes in the 8-hole. Clouds floating over the field now. Visibility getting a little more difficult. We'll see if at any point the lights come on. Normally they will start to heat up, but they usually won't make a full change until the top of an inning, as Cronin grounds one foul, just for equal lighting for both teams, so that if the Surfers batters were able to hit under the light in the bottom of the fifth when the Redlands Rays were not in the top of the fifth, it wouldn't necessarily be even. So big spot here for the Blue Wave. This game has been 2-1 since the first. Now Scott Cronin up in a situation where a fly ball scores a run and a ground ball potentially as well. And he takes down 3-2 now. Ashby getting his workout in this at bat. He's blocked several balls in the dirt, done a nice job to do so. Come on! Vocal dugout down on the surfer's side. Scott Cronin digs back in, and he'll face a 3-2 from Baker. We'll see if Baker goes to the off-speed with the risk of putting it in the dirt or the fastball. And it's the off-speed pitch, and it's a good one. And Cronin will sit down and swings through strike three. So it'll be young Wes Wilford pinch hitting for Hughes in a big spot. Wilford 1-for-3 on Friday night. A couple of strikeouts and dunked a single into right field against Reese Nitt. And the youngster comes up in a big spot, second and third, two outs, bottom of the fifth here. Surfers clinging to a 2-1 lead. Hyde no longer throwing, looks ready to go if needed. And Wilford takes upstairs from ball one. No action in the surfer's pen, and it looks like it'll be Chambers to go back out for the sixth. Coming to Wilford, and big breaking ball in there for a strike. And we mentioned on Friday night, sometimes when Wilford's feeling good in the box, you see a little bit of that Soto shuffle and a little bit of that walk out towards the pitcher. Long look in from Baker, big support coming from the surfer's dugout, looking for a hit to break this game open a little bit. And he takes a fastball upstairs. 2-1 now on Wilford. Settles himself, shakes his hair out, puts the helmet back on. Digs back into the muddy right-handed batter's box as Baker looks in to get the sign from Ashby. 2-1 coming. And pitches down, nice block by Ashby. Ashby done brilliantly to keep this game at 2-1 to this point, as Baker has found the dirt several times in the last two hitters. So it'll be a 3-1 coming to Wilford. If he were to reach, it would be Takahashi the shortstop, and then Cosgrove looming in the hole. Baker well over 100 pitches now. This will be number 109. The 3-1 to Wilford. Two outs here in the bottom of the fifth. And Wilford lines one down the left field line. It's going to twist foul. So just a little bit out in front of that one, and the count will go 3-2. In a big spot for the young Wes Wilford. In what you gotta figure may be Baker's last hitter if he can get him. And potentially his last hitter either way. Surfer's dugout getting loud. Wilford will see a 3-2 here with two outs in the bottom of the fifth. And both pitcher and hitter reset. Long look in from Baker. He knows what he wants and comes set. Full count pitch coming. And the 3-2. Fastball over the inside corner. And called strike three on Wilford. Wilford not a fan of the call. And Baker happy to get out of that one unscathed. Giving high fives to his teammates, looking like his night might be done. And in the meantime, we will go to the top of the sixth, surfers leading 2-1.
Thank you.
So here we are back. Top of the six. And we got a hit by pitch there on the first batter. As Owen's just taking a step out for now, I will continue on as I do. Seven Chambers on the mound still, continuing on here. Strike one. Turner at the plate. 0 for 1 today. Towards the net, Jerry's under it, see if it drops down early, but no. That one goes foul, and the count goes 0-2. Also, joining me in the press box / luxury suite here at the Roars, another co-commentator of mine from the season, Matt Beebe. How you going, Matty?
Yeah, thank you, John. It's good to be here. Nice facility here. It's nice to have real chairs.
Absolutely.
Chopped short. Looking for the double. Makes the play. Long think about it at the first base. Calls a double play. Nice work from Atsuki. Jod Ebel.
That one will clear the bases. Great play there by the infield.
Wes making his value worth, making himself worth early.
Yeah, good strength in the arm there to make it on the full, not short hopping Jai at first.
Bit of a stoush here, pitcher to pitcher. Two balls to Nitty. Ball low. It's three balls, no strikes. Strike middle. Count goes 3-1. Chambers delivers. Takes the hit, runs it in, nice and gentle-like, inning over.
As we go to the bottom of the sixth, Seth is still leading this one, 2-1. Take a short break. Thank you.
So bottom of the sixth now, it'll be Takahashi to lead it off for Surfers, followed by Cosgrove at the top of the order. New pitcher for Redlands is going to be Oscar Hyde. As Takahashi takes strike one. We'll get you Hyde's numbers as soon as we can. Just lost a little bit of the internet connection here. We'll bring that back shortly. The 0-1 to Takahashi is in the dirt. So Hyde this year on the mound, 32 innings pitched, 2-2 record, 30 hits, 22 earned runs, 34 strikeouts, and 39 walks. Now we have called a game before where Hyde came in relief against Surfers and talked about a little bit of the struggle with command. So that combined with the weather tonight will be interesting to note. And we'll see if the Surfers hitters can take advantage of that as Hyde slips off the mound halfway through his windup. As the rain continuing to fall, just a steady drizzle falling here at Windsor. Hyde in the postseason has gotten through no innings but allowed 3 earned runs. So he must have had one outing in which he did not record an out. And that fastball runs in there at 81 miles an hour, so throwing harder than either of the starters to this point. Rain coming down a little harder now. And a 1-2 pitch coming, and fastball well in the dirt. About 55 feet there, and Ashby unable to corral it, so it'll be 2-2. Beginning for Surfers here, bottom of the sixth, especially as the rain continues to fall. And 2-2 pitches grounded up the middle, and Melander gets in front of it, goes over to first, and in time to get the speedy Takahashi for the first out. And it'll be back around to the top for Surfers as Andy Cosgrove digs in. Cosgrove 0-for-2 today with a walk and a run scored. Scored on Durrington's double in the first. This game has been 2-1 since the first, as we're now in the bottom of the sixth. And Cosgrove takes the first pitch as a breaking ball upstairs. We'll just recap the scoring here. So in the first inning with the bases loaded, Dan Turner was hit by a pitch, which forced Anthony Gomez in as the first run. And Surfers responded with 2 runs of their own after Cosgrove's walk. Durrington hit a double to right center as Cosgrove takes down for ball 2, on which Cosgrove is able to score. And And later on in the inning, Harrison White grounded out to first, which allowed Durrington to get under the tag after Reese Nitt stepped on the bag and threw home. And that was the second run for Surfers. Nothing doing since then, although both teams have threatened at different times. 2-0 coming to Cosgrove. Breaking ball drops in there just outside for ball three. So if there's anyone you're going to green light, it's Cosgrove. And you would imagine if he gets the pitch he wants, he'll think about it. And has a look at a fastball for strike one. So big spot here for the Surfers' star third baseman. And the 3-1 coming from Hyde. And pitches down, ball four. So Cosgrove reaches for the second time via the walk. And that'll bring up Max Durrington. A lot of speed on the bases for Cosgrove, though Hyde with the left-handed move makes it a little more difficult. And it looks like Erasmus is out there walking around in the bullpen, not doing anything specific just yet. But ready to enter this game if need be. First pitch to Durrington is in for a strike. Durrington 1-for-3 with an RBI double today. And Hyde ready and comes set. And big breaking ball that goes over Durrington's head, almost hits the bat. So the count goes to 1-1. Hyde picks up the rosin, trying to get a grip. Still raining here at Windsor. And you have to think the ball getting a little more difficult to grip, the box getting a little more difficult for those hitters to work out of. And the 1-1 is upstairs, ball two. So Hyde behind in the count now, 2-1 to the young center fielder. Rain continuing to fall this steady, it'd be a good spot for the Blue Wave to put a couple of runs on here. And Durrington takes ball three down in the dirt. Jai Diebel, who homered on Friday night, is on deck. Cosgrove away from first. And pitch to Durrington, big swing and a foul straight back to the screen. Durrington trying to dig in a little bit to that left-handed batter's box. Hyde knows what he wants and comes set. 3-2 coming. Cosgrove stays put and Durrington takes ball four. So back-to-back walks for Hyde. We talked about his relative lack of control this year. And again, that combined with the weather. It'd be a reasonable idea for Surfers to stay patient here. One away, bottom six here for Jai Diebel. The lights are kicking into effect here as well at Windsor. Erasmus still sitting in the bullpen. No action as yet. And first pitch in the dirt. That one gets away from Ashby. Cosgrove going to make a move to third, and he's going to get there with no play. Durrington follows him up to second. And so now it's second and third and a 1-0 count with only one away to the Surfers' number three hitter. Surfers' biggest threat in the last couple of innings. And you have to wonder what Redlands' plan is with Erasmus not moving. You figure if the Rays show a chance to win today, perhaps they try to put their foot down with Erasmus. And if not, if Surfers is able to blow it open here, then perhaps you save him for Tuesday and try to use the combination of Erasmus and Nitt. to win the decider. Cosgrove away from third. Durrington from second as Deeble takes ball two. So Hyde continues to struggle to find the zone here. 18 pitches with only 6 strikes. We'll give you Griffin Baker's final line very shortly. And that pitch is in there for strike one. And both Deeble and Ashby have a surprised reaction to that one as Ashby sort of slid to make that reception. So perhaps not expecting the strike call. Nevertheless, the count goes to 2-1. Griffin Baker's final line, 5 innings, 4 hits, 2 runs, 2 earned, 5 walks, and 8 strikeouts. He threw 110 pitches and 58 strikes. Did a good job to battle in and out of trouble after the first inning. 2-1 coming now from Hyde. And that pitch is down and in. Ashby keeps it in front. And 3-1 now on Jai Deeble with Harrison White in the on-deck hole, on-deck circle. With Hyde's lack of command this inning, Deeble in a position to look for a pitch in one spot. And if he gets what he likes and finds a gap here, could put surfers up by a couple. And Deeble takes downstairs ball four. So that's 3 straight walks now, right through the heart of the order, 1, 2, and 3. And it's going to be Harrison White now, with the bases loaded and only one out. We'll see what Redlands does. It looks like the infield's moving in. Nitt out to have a chat with his young left-hander. So Nitt, in addition to starting pitching duties and batting and playing first base tonight, also manages the team. No action in the bullpen, so it's going to fall to Hyde to get himself out of trouble.
I don't know why I have a funny feeling about this. I've got that feeling again. Harry White at the plate.
Harry White 1-for-3 with an RBI. RBI ground out in the first as he swings through a fastball for strike one. Hyde's fastball sitting about 80-81 tonight. So White had the RBI ground out in the first as well as a line drive single up the middle his last time up. And a big spot for both teams. Looks like the corners are about in line with the bag, up the middle playing double play depth. 0-1 coming from Hyde. And curveball fouled away by Harry White, 69 miles an hour there. And a couple of big swings from Harry White. We'll see if he shortens up here now with 2 strikes. We've talked about Harry White, we've talked about his progression as a hitter over the last 2 years. See if he can come up big for the Blue Wave in this spot. And big swing on 0-2 and fouls it straight back. Steps out just a little farther now, looking to gather himself. A little bit frustrated with himself there, that may have been a good pitch to hit. Jerry Lacayo, the catcher on deck, followed by Ricky Deeble. Hyde comes set, 0-2 pitch coming here with one out in the sixth. And White takes down in the dirt for ball one. Big spot for the Blue Wave here, looking to push this best of three series to game three on Tuesday night, clinging to a one-run lead here in the sixth. 1-2 coming from Hyde, and curveball up and away for ball two. Outfield field straight up against Harry White. Two coming. And fastball away, and now the count runs full. So with one out and Cosgrove on third, you won't see the base runners go anywhere, but a big spot now for Harry White. Hyde has struggled to find the zone here, and if he were to walk, White would push a run across with his fourth straight walk. We'll see if Harry White can take advantage. Full count. And big swing on a high fastball and fouls it back to the screen. Just missed a couple of pitches here, has Harry. Still no movement in the Rays bullpen.
Come on, hey! Winner here! Winner's pitch! Oh, tennis!
White will see the seventh pitch of the at-bat. The 3-2. And it's right in there for strike three, so Harry White goes down looking. Potentially just looking for something else there, as no argument from White on the call. And so now the baton passes to Jerry Lucchese. We saw Lucchese on Friday night frustrated with himself after a pass ball led to Redlands able to score the go-ahead run. When they went up 1-0 in the bottom of the seventh. Lucchese takes ball one upstairs. Listed as 0 for 1 with two walks tonight, however, that last at-bat was a bunt attempt with a runner on first, so rightfully 0 for 0 with two walks tonight and the sacrifice. And that pitch is upstairs, ball two. So Lucchese now ahead in the count and in a position where he's looking for one pitch and only one. Five-nine, one of the leaders of this Surfers team. And he'll see a 2-0. And big swing by Jerry Lucchese. Helmet almost comes off as he swings through a 2-0 fastball for strike one. Hyde working hard this inning. 32 pitches already to this point. Only 13 for a strike. But he's thrown strikes when he's needed to get Harry White. And Lucchese takes a breaking ball over the inside corner for strike two. That one's 70 miles an hour, a slider from Hyde. And so now a 2-2 count to the Surfers catcher. You have to imagine there'll be some emotion if Hyde is able to get out of this. And it could be a big momentum swing in either direction depending on the outcome of this at-bat. Bases loaded, two outs here in the bottom of the sixth. 2-2 coming to Jerry Lucchese. The pitch is down in the dirt, blocked by Ashby, and Cosgrove stays put. And so now we will have action. Cosgrove will be released from third. Durrington released from second, and Diebel from first. The best speed you can have in the Blue Wave uniforms on the bases. A single from Lucchese likely scores two, a double likely scores three. Full count, two outs, bottom of the sixth, 2-1 Surfers here in game two of this best of three. The 3-2, ball four down in the dirt, and Jerry Lucchese takes a walk. Cosgrove will be forced home, and the Blue Wave take a 3-1 lead. So a great at-bat there by the Surfers catcher. And courtesy runner Jake Scott immediately out, as he has been all series. And Lucchese will enter to high fives from his teammates and is pumped about his third walk of the day. And the baton passes to Ricky Diebel. So Hyde's fourth walk of the inning. Has not yet allowed a hit. But we mentioned this with Hyde, the control issues this year combined with the weather. And four walks later, Surfers has a 3-1 lead. Two outs now, bases still loaded for Ricky Diebel. First pitch is downstairs for ball one. Still no movement in the Rays bullpen. Hyde will be on his own getting out of this as Diebel takes away ball two. So 2-0 now on the Surfers left fielder. And we've seen from Ricky Diebel's at-bats, he is in no hurry to give away any strikes, no hurry to swing if he doesn't want to swing. Two-oh pitch is fastball in there for strike one, 81 miles an hour from Hyde on that one. Two-one now coming to Diebel. And fastball on the inside corner for strike two. So Hyde again battles back to a 2-2 count. Two outs here in the bottom of the sixth. Surfers now leading 3-1. And Diebel swings through a fastball away, and Hyde is able to get out of the inning. But not before walking in a run to allow Surfers to extend the lead to 3-1 as we go to the top of the seventh. So back here in the top of the seventh, it'll be Melander to lead it off for Redlands. And Steve Chambers' night is done. We'll give you his final line. 6 innings, 2 hits, 1 run, 1 earned, 3 walks, and 1 strikeout. 80 pitches and 42 strikes. And Chambers did a nice job, as did Griffin Baker, of battling through after a bit of a shaky start, battling through, trying to throw strikes and eat some innings for his team. It'll be Doug Breeze in for the Blue Wave. We saw Doug Breeze briefly on Friday night, who was put into a difficult situation with the bases loaded and only one out. And after a long battle with Kyle Pike, lost that battle as Pike singled softly up the middle to win the game for Redlands. Melander 0 for 2 today. And pitches a fastball about 83 miles an hour there from Breeze on the corner for strike one. Breeze was 86-87 on Friday. And we'll see if the weather affects his velocity. And his fastball 85 off the corner there for a ball. And pitches hit by Melander in the deep center field. Durrington tracking it back and makes the play. So a well-struck ball by Kynan Melander falls into the glove of Max Durrington for out number one. So it'll be Beckham Crooks now for Redlands. Crooks 0 for 1 with a walk tonight. And first pitch to Crooks, the fastball upstairs from ball one. Breeze ready to go. And finds the zone there for strike one. So count levels on Crooks. You got Ryan Duncan for his fourth time on deck. And fastball away for strike two right on the corner. So Crooks in the 1-2 hole. Pitch is big, slow curveball off the edge. And the count levels at 2-2. Breeze comes set, and it'll be a 2-2 to Crooks. And fastball downstairs, ball three. So Crooks has not swung the bat yet and worked himself into a 3-2 count. Big at bat for Breeze to get through. Always trying to get the nine hitter if you can. No disrespect to Crooks, but you always want to get the nine guy in advance of the top of the order. And pitches a fastball, dunked towards right field, and it's going to twist foul and out of play. So it'll be another 3-2 to Crooks. And pitches a fastball. Crooks gets his bat on it, fouls it away, and we'll do it again. Good at bat by Beckham Crooks here to work Breeze's pitch count. So it'll be another 3-2 from Breeze. And the pitch is on the corner for strike three. Crooks not a fan of the call. Mikeo does a nice job to snap it up into the corner for strike three. And so two away now for Ryan Duncan. We're back to the top of the Redlands order. Duncan 0 for 2 with a walk today. Redlands 2 for 21 on the day as Duncan takes a ball just under the hands. Both of those two belong to the man on deck, Anthony Gomez, who's had himself a nice game. that pitch is just downstairs from ball two. Bree's just missing inside a couple of pitches here. Two oh now coming from surfer's right-hander and misses inside for ball three. So Bree's sitting 83 to 85 tonight with the fastball, about 68 to 70 with the curveball. And fastball under the hands for strike one.
Come on, Doug, here we go.
Three one coming to Ryan Duncan. And pitches a fastball, chopped up the first base line, twisting back, but passes it foul. Diebel picks it up, flicks it back to his starting pitcher. And the rain softening up here a little bit at Windsor. But it has done its damage on the dirt as the infield is looking fairly muddy all around at all the positions. Three, two now from Breeze. Fastball fouled back to the screen. So Breeze having to work here after Crooks had a good at bat and Duncan having a good at bat as well. But anything he can do to keep Gomez from coming to the plate with a runner on would be a positive for surfers. And that is ball four. So Duncan finds his way aboard. And Gomez will indeed get a look here in the seventh. Gomez two for three with a double today. And in this final series, after a two for four on Friday, he is four for seven. So leading the charge of the Redlands offense in a series that has so far been relatively scarce in terms of run scoring. Long look in from Breeze, now comes set. Runner on first, two outs here in the seventh. And pitches away, ball one to Gomez. Duncan not really a speed threat. Breeze does take some time in terms of his delivery to get to the plate with a full leg kick there. Big slow curveball drops in just above the zone for ball two. If Gomez were to reach, it would be Tyson Zamora, the speedy center fielder from Redlands. Gomez doing some gardening now in the box on his cleats. Just trying to get comfortable on a day where the weather has made things relatively uncomfortable for both hitters and pitchers today. Two oh coming now from Gomez. From Breeze rather, to Gomez, and it's in the dirt. Ball three. And down there in the surfer's bullpen, it's Matt Boyce. Right-handed fireballer getting loose. And it looks like Justin Erasmus continuing to stay loose here. Over for the Rays. So conference on the mound now, Cosgrove comes out, umpire coming out, and Kevin Fenn coming out. And not sure what the go is here, potentially an injury from Breeze, but not sure.
Might be talking about the mound conditions.
And that's gonna do it for Doug Breeze. So you have to hope that he's okay. So now a bit of a snafu for surfers as Kevin Fenn was likely not prepared for that. And it looks like Boyce is going to come in on short warm-up. So you figure he might get a little extra time to get hot here. But in the meantime, it looks like Breeze's day is done. So 2/3 of an inning, 1 walk, 1 strikeout, 21 pitches, 10 strikes. And it'll be Boyce in to face Gomez, and he'll be starting with a 3-0 count. So we'll leave it here while Matt Boyce gets warmed up in the top of the seventh with Surfers leading 3-1. So it's going to be Matt Boyce in for Surfers. We'll give you a little look at his numbers from this year. So regular season, Boyce 17 innings out of the relieving role, 3 saves this season, 15 hits, 7 runs, and 25 strikeouts, only 9 walks. So 25 strikeouts in 17 innings. We know Matt Boyce is a fan of the Ks per 9. So 25 into 17. So 13.2 Ks per 9 for Boyce in the regular season. Amongst the tops in the league, you would think, as he comes in to face Gomez with a 3-0. And pitches a fastball in at 85 for strike one. Boyce this postseason 4 1/3 innings, 2 runs, 3 strikeouts. And the 3-1 is in there for strike two. So Gomez all of a sudden facing a full count as Boyce has come in and electrified with a couple of fastballs on the corner. And that releases Duncan from first with 2 outs. Mikhail reminding his infielders to go across to first base as Duncan will have taken off for second. Gomez again doing some gardening, trying to get the cleats clean. And so now it'll be a 3-2, and we'll see if Boyce can bounce back here. You would expect a bit of emotion if he's able to punch out Gomez here from a 3-0 count. And Gomez, it's a hard ground ball to Wilford, who makes a nice pick. Gomez slips coming out of the box and will make no effort to run it out. So Boyce does an excellent job of getting out of that one and getting through Gomez. And we'll go to the bottom of the seventh with Surfers leading 3-1. Thank you. So back here, bottom of the seventh, and it'll be Scott Cronin to lead it off for Surfers out of the seven hole. 7-8-9 for the Blue Wave, as it'll be Wilford and Takahashi to follow. Hyde out there for his second inning of work after a precarious first inning of work in which he allowed only one run but walked four.
Convinced by the umpires here. What they're talking about.
First base umpire now having a conversation with Reese Knitt, the manager.
Asking for the grounds crew.
It looks like they're asking for the grounds crew now, so potentially some concern about the conditions. We did see Gomez slip out of the batter's box. On the ground ball he hit to Wilford, so maybe some concern for player safety here.
Anybody know that grounds crew are?
Home plate umpire James Shields asking for grounds crew. Looks like they're looking to continue play but clean up the batter's box at home, which has gotten really quite muddy. Not sure if you can fully appreciate it on the stream. Now, in terms of how this affects the Blue Wave, this would only be a good thing, as they are holding on to a lead at the moment, and they are the home team.
We still have ground screw here, please. Somebody's coming down.
So we'll step away for a moment. It looks like they're going to sort out a grounds crew to Testing. After the stream dropped out briefly at an absolutely perfect time, given that the Windsor grounds crew is just looking to control the batter's box a little bit. Looks like we're getting closer here. And it looks like the crew's ready to go. So a nice hand for the grounds crew, and it'll be Scott Cronin digging in here in the bottom of the seventh. Surfers leading 3-1. See how the delay affects Hyde, who threw a couple of warm-up pitches early on. And first pitch to Cronin upstairs for ball one. Scott Cronin 0 for 3, 3 strikeouts today, looking to avoid the golden sombrero. 1-0 pitch is fastball in the corner for strike one. One coming now from Hyde. And Cronin swings and dumps one into left center field. Looks like that's going to be down for a base hit. So Cronin breaks the schneid. After three straight strikeouts, drops a single into left center field. And Surfers has the leadoff hitter aboard. Cronin getting a bit of ribbing from his teammates here. Looks like that's Declan Summerford out there asking to keep the ball as a memory for Cronin. So it's Wes Wilford here, the second baseman. He pinch hit for Hughes last time up and struck out. Wilford versus Hyde here in the seventh. And shows bunt, and bunt's foul. So a good bunt situation here for Wilford in the 3-1 game late. And we'll see if he shows it again. It's Takahashi and Cosgrove to follow. Cronin sorting himself out over at first, just relacing the shoes. Wilford set. And the 0-1 coming from Hyde. And pitches upstairs, ball one. So it'll be a 1-1 to the young Wilford. And pitches upstairs, ball two. Hyde 46 pitches now. No action in the Redlands bullpen and the tarp is on. 2-1 coming to Wilford. And Cronin takes off, pitches upstairs, ball three, throw down to second, is not in time. So Cronin takes second base on a one-hop throw from Ashby that doesn't get there in time. And now Wilford ahead, 3-1. We'll be looking to move him over to third with a ball to the right side. Second stolen base of the game for Surfers, as Ricky Diebel took a bag earlier today. Three-one coming to Wilford now. And pitches a fastball on the outside corner for strike two. So another full count from Hyde, who has had to work. And ball four to Wilford. So Wilford will be aboard. So a single by Cronin and a walk to Wilford. Fifth walk of the game for Hyde in one plus innings pitched to this point. We'll bring up Takahashi. First and second, nobody out. And the dangerous Andy Cosgrove looming on deck. So a big spot for Surfers. And we'll see what the shortstop can do. In a bunt situation here, Turner will come in on the lip. And Reese Knitt also aggressively in on the lip. Turner giving signs to his infielders, determining who's going to be responsible for the lines and who's going to be responsible covering third. Takahashi at the plate has not yet shown as Hyde comes set. And a pickoff play. And Cronin back. Perhaps some miscommunication. Some discussion from Kevin Fenn now about whether or not that was a balk. saying that Hyde did not step off, and if he spun, he had to throw. But no balk call made. And Hyde steps off. So potentially some miscommunication there from the Redlands infield, maybe someone missing one of the defensive signs. And same play, wheel play on for Redlands as Takahashi shows, pulls back, and pitch is called a strike. Takahashi a little bit surprised, thought it was outside. So wheel play on means that Turner sprints for home as Gomez heads towards third. It means Turner's responsible for the line there and Hyde likely responsible for the first base line or any bunt towards the center. And we'll see if they run the same play as Gomez walks Cronin back to second and we'll see if he takes off for third. And he does, so the wheel play on again. Hyde comes home and Takahashi lines one into center field. Zamora on the run. Oh, and a fantastic diving catch by Tyson Zamora. Scott Cronin makes a good decision there on the line drive to go back, tag, and go to third. But a spectacular catch by the speedy center fielder from Redlands and getting a well-deserved round of applause. And Zamora now taking his time to get up. That ball well struck by Takahashi. Sorry, John, go ahead.
Just looking on the replay at the Cronin's tag, and he does tag. And
so excellent base running there from Scott Cronin, because that's a ball that many may have assumed would get down, but Cronin stuck to the fundamentals, freezing on a line drive, knowing that Zamora is fast out there and has made a couple of diving catches this series already, and headed back to the bag, knowing Zamora might get to it. And with Zamora laying out, even though he wasn't particularly far or deep into right center, that allowed Cronin to move to third because Zamora was unable to get much on the throw. Looks like he's still walking it off out there in center as Reese Nitt had walked out to check on him. So between the weather delay for cleaning up the box and now the injury check on Zamora, this game has slowed to somewhat of a crawl. However, it is an exciting situation here for the Blue Wave with first and third and only one out, and their star third baseman Cosgrove coming to the plate. But can't say enough about that catch by Zamora. That's one of those catches where we wish we had professional MLB angles to show you, because that was full extension, spectacular leaping catch. Leaping, diving into right center field, saving two runs at least and potentially a triple from Takahashi. And we'll see if it pays off for Redlands as Cosgrove now comes to the plate. Hyde steps off. And they're checking the tag on Cronin, who had appeared from where we were easily tagged up. So no avail there, as expected. And it'll be Cosgrove at the plate, runners on the corner. So we'll see what happens with Wilford at first. Left-hander Hyde, Nitt not holding him on. We'll see if Ashby takes a shot at throwing him out if the young Wilford takes off. And Nitt drops back and swinging a foul ball by Cosgrove. Big spot in this game here, Hyde versus Cosgrove, runners on first and third, one out. Nitt now holding on Wilford, and pitches downstairs, ball one. Cronin dances back towards third. Cosgrove 0 for 2 with two walks tonight after a 2 for 3 performance in game one. Also scored a run. Two runs, rather. Scored on Durrington's double in the first. and he takes downstairs ball two. Scored on Durrington's double in the first, as well as the walk by Hyde in the prior inning. To Jerry Lacayo. So Cosgrove now in a favorable count. Two balls and a strike. And Cosgrove takes downstairs ball three. So Hyde struggling to find the zone, being careful with Cosgrove here. And if Cosgrove were to reach, it'd be the young Max Durrington to follow. Durrington 1-for-3 with a double today. Wilfred still on first, hasn't shown any signs of running. 3-1 coming to Cosgrove, and the pitch is ball four. Misses up and away, and Cosgrove on base with his third walk of the day. And so that brings the lefty Max Durrington to the plate. So the Cronin single, the Wilfred walk. The brilliant catch by Zamora to Rob Takahashi, followed by the Cosgrove walk, and the Blue Wave have the bases loaded with Max Durrington at the plate here in the seventh. And Durrington swings, first pitch grounder to second. Oh, and Cosgrove tagged out, unable to get out of the way of Melander. And that allows Melander to make a quick throw over to first to turn the double play. So an unfortunate situation there. Cosgrove headed towards second. The ball hit in really the only place that it could be for Redlands to get an easy double play. And just like that, the rally is snuffed out, and we will go to the top of the eighth with the Blue Wave leading 3-1. So it's Tyson Zamora, the center fielder for Redlands, to lead it off. Brilliant play to help limit the Blue Wave, or prevent the Blue Wave from scoring last inning. Laying out in right center field to Rob Takahashi of an extra base hit. And now he gets a chance to do it with the bat. First pitch to Zamora is a fastball in there from Boyce for strike one. Boyce starting to feel himself out there on the mound. Boyce, unlike Chambers or Breeze, is quite emotive when he's pitching, for better or worse. And pitches outside ball one. If we're lucky, we might see a couple of thigh slaps, which he'll go to in a big spot. And breaking ball from Boyce. Zamora swings through for strike two. Good pitch from the surfer's right-hander. And boys right back on the mound and ready to go. One, two coming. And fastball, Zamora flies it into shallow left. Cosgrove chasing, Diebel chasing. Ball is out of play. One, two now on the Redlands center fielder. Zamora 0 for 3 tonight. Five home runs to lead the team this regular season. Pitches just off the edge for ball two. Lakeo holding that one for just a little longer, and Boyce looking to want that one as well. But nothing doing, and the count goes to 2-2 on Zamora. Two is fastball, flied towards left field. Ricky Diebel chasing it over. Looks like he's underneath it, and just in foul territory, makes the play. So Zamora fouls out to left for the first out of the eighth, and Redlands now five outs remaining to see if they can scratch two runs across and extend this game. It'll be Ashby to the plate now. Ashby 0 for 2 with a walk. Boyce set, and the leg hang before the fastball down and away. That one up to 87, so Boyce starting to find his rhythm. And Boyce known to throw in the hesitation from time to time. And pitches a fastball fisted towards first base. Jai Diebel makes the play, slips, and still able to make the throw over to Boyce. Great job by Diebel to stay with that. And he is walking around over there at first, making sure everything's all right. Looks like he's fine. So another example of a really just a difficult playing condition for these players on the field. We've seen it coming out of the batter's box. We've seen pitchers slip tonight. Just everyone slipping and sliding all over the place. But again, this grounds crew's done everything they can. I think most days, I think in the regular season, you probably don't play all the games today. But Grand Final is a different beast. And a nice job by Boyce to get over on that ball as well. First pitch to Pike is hammered to left field. Ricky Diebel had it played well though, and makes the catch. So no issues, Boyce pumped coming off the mound, and Surfers three outs away from forcing a decisive game three on Tuesday. Blue Wave lead 3-1 here as we go to the bottom of the eighth. Thank you. So Jai Deeble here, the three hitter for Surfers to lead off the bottom of the eighth. Hyde still out there. Hyde 57 pitches so far in this game. And Deeble has a big swing on a pitch down in the dirt and falls off balance. That'll be strike one. Deeble making sure he can get a reasonable grip in the box there with his back foot and finds some solid ground and settles in. So 0-1 coming from Hyde. And pitch is fastball down. One ball, one strike now on the Surfers first baseman. It's Harry White to follow and then Jerry Lacayo. 3-4-5 for the Blue Wave in the eighth. Is in there for a strike to Deeble. And don't know exactly the plan for Surfers in the ninth as Boyce has looked good, but you do see Andy Cosgrove down there in the pen getting loose. So potentially Boyce, and if he allowed a base runner, you'd go to Cosgrove, or potentially Cosgrove to save some bullets for Boyce so that you could use him on Tuesday if needed. As Ashby blocks a ball down in the dirt, count goes to 2-2. For the Rays in the ninth, it was Pike to finish last inning. So it'll be Turner, Nitt, and Melander, unless there are any pinch hitters. That's 6-7-8 for the Rays. And Deeble takes downstairs ball three. Still no action in the Rays pen. Hyde being asked to carry the load to some degree, probably trying to save some of their pitchers for a potential Tuesday game at this point as well. Full count now to Jai Deeble. And pitches line towards right field and crooks underneath it. And that's out number one. So Deeble goes to 0-for-3 today now with a couple of walks to his name, and it's Harry White now 1-for-4 with an RBI today to face the Redlands lefty. And takes in the dirt for ball one. Coming now to the Surfers lefty. And pitch is swung on and hit high in the air down the left field line, shallow. Gomez converging with Turner. Oh, and a beautiful catch by Anthony Gomez, sliding into the wall in foul territory. Covered a tremendous amount of ground to get to that ball, and now looked like he slid sort of awkwardly into the wall, walking it off. And throws the ball back in. Must have made a joke out there, as there's some laughter in the bullpen, so he's okay. Really great series for Gomez so far with the bat and defensively, Friday and today. He has been all over the place for Redlands, making plays to his left and right. So unfortunate for Harry White as the baton is passed to Lacayo. Lacayo 0-for-1 with three walks, and recall the 0-for was a bunt that I would have imagined might have been scored as a sacrifice as he takes upstairs ball one. So Redlands has flashed the leather the last couple of innings with that Zamora catch in center and the Gomez play down the line there in foul territory and left. as Lakeo takes strike one. Reminiscent of Derek Jeter flying into the stands 20 years ago. And 1-1 is upstairs. Josh Warner come out on the on-deck circle for Ricky Diebel. So we'll see if he gets a chance to swing the bat. As Lakeo fouls it back with a big swing. We heard Warner earlier today in the booth tell us that he considers himself a hitter, but that he might be the only one. He's got a chance to prove to everyone else tonight, if he gets an at-bat, that he is one as well. Two, two coming to Lakeo. And that pitch is fouled back. Lakeo's put together some good at-bats today. Reached base three times. And another good at-bat here against Hyde. 2-2, two outs in the eighth. And pitches down for ball three. Ashby tries to snap it back up, but umpire James Shields not fooled. So the count goes full now. On what will be Hyde's 72nd pitch. And Lakeo rips one into left field. That's going to be over Duncan's head and off the wall. Lakeo digging for second, and he'll slide in safely. Missed a home run there by about 4 feet. Jerry Lakeo with one more degree of launch angle, and that ball's over the wall. Great swing there by Lakeo. And it's Jai Diebel now coming out as the courtesy runner. And that'll give Josh Warner, our guest from earlier today, his first look in the box. Warner had very limited appearances in the box, was 3-for-9. Didn't pick up a triple in the regular season. And first pitch is upstairs. Diebel thinks about it, but stays put.
I don't know how many guest commentators actually play in the end of a grand final.
In the same game.
At bat, in the same game.
Well, wouldn't it just be justice if Warner was able to knock in another run for Surfers after telling us that he considered himself a hitter up in the booth just a couple of innings ago?
Why not?
1-0 from Hyde, Diebel away from second. And Warner takes ball two. You got to imagine he doesn't want to walk. He's not up there to walk. I mean, he'll take it if it's given, but anything close, I think you see a big swing from Josh Warner here. Anything he likes. And a big swing from Josh Warner, and swings through it. Looks like Hyde had the same thought, throwing him an off-speed on 2-0. And Warner swings through it, so it's 2-1 now. On the Big Surfer's presumed left fielder, if he goes in for Ricky Diebel. Though you figure you might put someone else in there after this at-bat, as Warner fouls it back. Hyde really having to work here. Still no action in the bullpen. It's gonna be Hyde. Cronin on deck. Warner will see a 2-2. And that pitch is called strike three. Looked maybe a little down, maybe a little off the corner. Warner not a fan of the call, but called out regardless. And so this game's gonna go to the ninth with Surfers leading 3-1.
Josh came in to pinch it for Rick and Deegan.
So back here, top of the ninth, last licks for the Rays. Surfers looking to force a deciding game three on Tuesday night, and the Rays looking for a miracle comeback here and to end the series tonight. After the Warner strikeout pinch hitting for Diebel, Warner not going back out to the field, so his day is done. He will be replaced by Jake Scott in left field. And it's still Boyce with a couple of thigh slaps to get himself ready to go here in the ninth. It's going to be 6-7-8, Turner, and it looks like Wyatt pinch hitting for Nick. And then if all else were to be the same, it would be Melander in the eighth. Boyce misses just down for ball one. Yeah, 1-0 now to Turner. And pitches in there for a strike, 86 miles an hour from Boyce. One fastball, Turner fouls it away, and Boyce ahead in the count 1-2. Coming into this inning, Boyce had gone an inning and a third, 12 pitches, 9 strikes. Been right around the zone, working efficiently. We did see Cosgrove getting loose in the pen just in case. But right now, it's all Matt Boyce. 1-2 pitch coming to Turner. And fastball, Turner fouls it away. Turner 0-2 today. Hit by pitch and an RBI in the first. We'll see what Boyce chooses to do here, whether he tries to light up the radar gun or spin an off-speed pitch through to fool Turner. 1-2 coming. And fastball is grounded hard to third. Cosgrove stays down. And across the diamonds to Diebel for the first out. So Surfer's two outs away now. So if Redlands unable to come back here, Hyde's night would be done at 3 innings, 2 hits, 1 run, 1 earned, 6 walks, and 3 strikeouts, 77 pitches and 36 strikes. And it's Wyatt to pinch hit for Nitt. First pitch is above the zone just for ball one, 88 miles an hour there from Boyce, who's starting to dial it up. It looks like the rain has pretty much stopped here. And the lights are on as this game has turned fully into a night game at this point based on the weather. And pitch fastball up and under the hands for ball two. So a quick look at Matt Wyatt's regular season. 373 average in 32 games. With a couple of home runs as well as he swings through a high fastball. 87 miles an hour there. 475 slugging as well, and an 891 OPS. In the playoffs, Wyatt hitting 308, 4 for 13. And Boyce steps off and summons Lacayo out for a visit. Boyce now set and ready. It'll be a 2-1 to Wyatt. And fastball upstairs. Breaking ball, rather. 3-1 now. Boyce 21 pitches and counting. And fastball in there for strike two. So now Wyatt has a full count. It's Melander on deck. Boyce toes the rubber. And comes set. Full count pitch coming to Wyatt. And fastball is blooped towards second, and Wilford's underneath it and makes the play. So Boyce wins that battle, and it's all up to Melander to keep Redland's hopes alive. Matt Boyce looking to shut the door and force this series to a decisive game three on Tuesday. It's been a great day of baseball. We saw a good win for the Division II team earlier today to win the championship. And Boyce looking to cap off what would be a very successful Sunday for Surfers here at Windsor. And keep them alive for the Div 1 title. First pitch to Melander is lashed into right field for a base hit. So Melander all over the fastball there, looking for it, got it, and didn't wait. And so he passes the baton to Beckham Crooks.
Just want to jump in quickly and say thanks everyone for tuning in as we hit over 110 to 118 people tuning in. Make sure you subscribe to the channel and hit the bell icon to get notifications when Tuesday's game goes live at 7 o'clock on Tuesday. Just want to say thank you again to Owen for helping me out today and on Friday night. Really appreciate it.
First pitch to Crooks, a fastball strike. Yeah, John, always a pleasure. This is all because of you that we're able to do this, and we really look forward to it. I will not be on the stream Tuesday as I am unable to be here, but I know that and have heard John's commentary has been excellent the times he's been doing it. And so everyone will be in great hands for what we hope to see as a decisive game three if Boyce is able to get through Crooks here. Melander not being held on as his run is of no import. The only concern for the Blue Wave is preventing Redlands from scoring two. You think Melander would consider taking second with no one holding him on. And 86 just above the zone. Boyce dialed up now. Was sitting 83, 85 earlier, now sitting 86 to 88. Down the stretch of this game. Come set. And pitch. Fastball upstairs. Boys, 27 pitches now. And delivery to Crooks. Crooks goes right through it, and we go to 2-2. So it's Melander away from first, and the Rays are down to their final strike. Surfers looking to send this three-game series to Tuesday night and delay any coronation. And fastball right by Beckham Crooks into the glove of Jerry Lacayo, 88 miles an hour from Boyce. And the Blue Wave have done it. A solid team effort and a 3-1 victory, and they have forced a game three.
So I believe it's a 6-year since this Blue Wave side have held onto that trophy, and now just one game away from hoisting the trophy and be crowned champions of the Div 1 summer season. Make sure you tuned in on Tuesday night for that game, because it's going to be a cracker, the decider. Don't want to miss one pitch of it.
I can say I'll be tuned in for sure as one of your avid viewers and listeners. It would be great to break your stream record. I know, what was it, game three last week? 160, yeah, 170?
180, I think we hit. So
Yes, make sure you're sharing the next game link on all your Facebook profiles and join in the chat. And I appreciate everyone for tuning in tonight. And my guest commentators, Sammy Foster and Josh Warner, for doing a few guest spots. But that is it from us at Windsor. I want to thank Windsor for hosting us, being very hospitable to us, putting us up in the Royal Suite, and being very generous with their equipment and their space. So yes, that is it from Windsor. Game tied, one apiece. We head to a decider Tuesday night. You've been watching SPBC TV. I am John Reimers, your host, and good night.
Nice job.
Good swing, Xavier. Good swing.